Cool sunny Sunday in Kansas City. Game 5 promised to put one team within one victory of its first world championship. The early hero is Frank White. His outstanding defensive work at second typified the day's effort. White raced away from the infield and into the sun to deprive Bob Boone and turn a double play. One inning later, the easiest of plays paved the way for the game's first run. Big McBride's grounder was fielded and thrown handily enough by Larry Gura, but Willie Akins found the bag too late to retire McBride. Moments later, that error loomed large as Bake trotted home ahead of Mike Schmidt, both ticketed by a Schmidt drive to the green and center. In the fifth, the Royals scratched out a run on two hits and a sacrifice. But for an umpire's call, they might have scored more. With runners at first and third and two out, Hal McRae banged a drive to the right field corner. Bake McBride disappeared from the view of most fans and came away with the baseball. Only the replay from center field seemed to indicate that the third out had been clearly trapped off the wall. Undaunted, the Royals came back an inning later, and Amos Otis put one where no judgment call had to be made. His third homer of the series tied the game at 2. A pair of singles and a sacrifice gave KC a one-run lead that figured to get bigger when Willie Wilson doubled to the bullpen fence and right. Dake McBride's rebound and Manny Trio's relay made an easy out of a tiring Darryl Porter at the plate, and just like that, a Royal threat was ended. Through two innings, Dan Quisenberry's arm and Frank White's glove protected that lead. A potential RBI single by Trio was turned into a third out in the seventh. And in the eighth, Frank went far to his left to prevent a leadoff single by Larry Boa. The Royals coasted into the ninth, but then saw their lead snatched by the Phillies. In the final frame, Mike Schmidt led things off with a shot off the glove of a pulled-in George Brett. And suddenly, the lead run was at the plate in the form of pinch hitter Del Unser. Just as suddenly, Unser doubled past the slow-reacting Akins at first. Schmidt raced home to tie the game at 3. The critics wondered why Pete LeCocq had not replaced Akins for defensive purposes. After Quisenberry got 2 outs, the lead run was at 3rd when Trio lined one up the middle. Brett played the ricochet, but too late to prevent a 4-3 Philly lead. It was left to reliever Tug McGraw to make the 9th inning a nail-biter for fans of both teams. Philly's bullpen ace sandwiched 2 outs between walks to Frank White, to Willie Akins, and to Amos Otis. And then, with the tying run at third and the winning run at first, Tug McGraw sailed a high fastball pass to swinging Jose Cardinal and put Game 5 on the books. Tonight, back home in Philadelphia, the Phillies will attempt to capture the title they've never won, and the Royals will fight to get even in Game 6 of the 1980 World Series. NBC Sports presents the 1980 World Series, an inside look at the series and a preview of Game 6. Brought to you by Exxon, people finding and developing energy for you. And by the Hartford and its independent agents who can protect your business, home, auto, and life. Here at Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia, a crowd of over 65,000 has packed the Vet in the hopes of seeing the Phillies do something they've never done, that is win a world title. The Royals hope to send them home unhappy and bring them back here for Game 7 tomorrow night. Good evening and welcome to Philadelphia. I'm Bryant Gumbel. Welcome to Game 6. As I'm sure all of you know, the Phillies are out in front in games by a score of 3-2. They will start tonight, lefty Steve Carlton, their ace. The Royals will counter with Rich Gale, their starting pitcher, in Game 3. There'll be a couple of changes in the starting lineup. Jose Cardinal will start in right. John Wathan will start behind the plate for the Royals. For the Phillies, the man on the bench and the man to watch, once again, will be Del Unser. He has come off the bench twice in this series with key pinch hits, conjuring up memories of Dusty Rhodes and his pinch hitting of 51. Del, do you find it flattering to be labeled a modern-day Dusty Rhodes?
Well, I don't really know. I don't like to be labeled anything but Del. I just like to do what I can do in a situation whenever they call on me.
It has been a tremendous string of pinch hits, though. So what do you attribute the success?
I think Billy DeMars has helped me immensely in just shortening my stroke. When I came down here from Montreal, I had trouble with a great big stroke and trying to hit home runs. Instead, I tried to shorten it up and wound up hitting more home runs last year and just driving the ball well this year.
Manny Mota's the all-time pinch hit leader. I know he tells me that when he thinks he's going to be going in a game, about the fifth inning, he goes in the back and starts swinging. Do you have a routine you go through?
Well, George Vukovich, Greg Gross, and myself, all three left-handed pinch hitters, we'll go up and down the runway at about the third, fifth, seventh innings and loosen up in the clubhouse and swing a lot and talk about what pitchers are in their bullpen. And see if we've got anything on them. For example, have their pitches or have an idea as to how they'll pitch us. And I get information throughout the game from the left-handed hitters that I'm talking with, too, so that helps.
Getting the two pinch doubles has got to be a great deal of satisfaction. Does it make you feel like you've contributed as much as any starter to this series?
Well, to the series, it does. The playoffs and the series, it's great to contribute when the game is really on the line, and that's very rewarding to me personally, and I know it is to the rest of the guys. They know I work hard, and I know they work hard, and it's kind of a mutual thing. It's pretty much a team.
Del Unser, thank you very much.
Thank you, Brian.
Much appreciated. It has worked out fine every time Del Unser has pinch hit, but there has been room for some second guessing in this series, and we will second guess with Jim Frey and Bake McBride when we come back. Part of the fun of being a baseball fan is the chance to second guess players, managers, calls. Sunday's game provided that opportunity, particularly against a man named Jim Frey, who managed the ninth inning, saw Kansas City Royals lose a 3-2 lead, lose a 4-3 ball game. Jim, let me start off first of all by asking you, why didn't you replace Willie Akins with Pete LeCocq in the top of the ninth?
Well, my reason really was that in a one-run ball game, of course, and with this ball club out here, Phillies, they have been able to come back. In the previous game, as a matter of fact, in the third ball game, I did much the same thing. I kept Willie in. We had a one-run lead going into the eighth. I left him in the ball game because the possibility of them tying it, I wanted him to hit. In that ball game, he turned out to be the hero. In the 10th inning, he got a base hit to win it. And my thinking was the same in the fifth game, really.
But that's a move you've made defensively throughout the year, so it was just by the Phillies? It was because of the Phillies you didn't make the move?
Not really. It was the situation, the one-run lead, really, more than anything. Any club you're playing, they can come up with a run. It doesn't have to involve the first baseman. And I like to have the big fella, especially he's been swinging the bat real well for us. I wanted to have him available if that situation arose.
Okay, let's move to the bottom of the ninth. Bases loaded, two out. Cardinal due to hit. A lot of people are wondering why you didn't hit John Wathan, who on record is a better hitter.
Well, as a matter of fact, we acquired Cardinal to be a right-handed hitter against left-hand pitching. During the time that he was with our ball club, I played him against some left-handers and pinch hitting. He hit 340 for us in that role, as a matter of fact. Did a very good job for us, and I felt as if he knew McGraw. I felt he'd be comfortable in that situation against McGraw, and that's the reason I went with him.
Okay, Jim Frey, thank you very much. The most controversial call of Game 5 occurred in the sixth inning. Royals had themselves a 3-2 lead. There were two out, runners on first and third, when Hal McCray hit a ball to the corner and right. Bake McBride went to the corner and came away with a baseball in his glove, but there still seems to be some debate on whether the ball was caught or whether it was trapped. It was ruled a catch, end of inning, end of Royals rally. Bake McBride, let me ask you, and look me in the eye, don't look away. Did you catch the baseball?
I can't really tell you. You know, when I went to the wall, I closed my eyes, and, the ball was in my glove. So.
Hold it. You closed your eyes?
I closed my eyes because I saw the wall, and, I didn't want nothing to happen to my face. So, I can't really say if I caught the ball or not. I don't know if it hit off the wall or if it hit in my glove first.
Did it feel like it hit in the webbing of the glove or off the thumb part like it would if it was trapped?
It hit off the thumb part and went into the webbing. And, I can't say if it hit the wall first or not.
Will that answer change after the series?
No, I'm going to still have the same answer. I can't tell you if I caught the ball or not.
Having seen it on the replay, what do you think?
I think I caught it. I do. Because it looks like it hit the thumb of my glove first and then it went into the webbing.
You closed your eyes. If that isn't an answer for an election year, I don't know what is. Big thank you much. We're going to step aside for just a moment. When we come back, we will say goodbye to two old friends of baseball, a tribute to Bill Veeck and Charlie Finley, right after this. Since this could be our last baseball show of 1980, it could also be our last chance to say goodbye to two of baseball's most controversial and combative figures over the year, a tribute of sorts to Bill Veeck and Charlie Finley. In 1946, Bill Veeck, at the age of 32, became the owner of the Cleveland Indians. And 2 years later, the Indians rewarded him with their first pennant in 28 years and drew over 2.6 million fans. 3 years later, in 1951, the headline-conscious Veeck took over the lowly St. Louis Browns and produced a 3-foot-7-inch pinch hitter named Eddie Goodell, who walked on four pitches before being barred from baseball the next day. In 1959, Veeck bought the Chicago White Sox, who promptly won their first pennant since 1919. Within 2 years, he retired because of illness. 14 years later, in 1975, Beck returned to Chicago just in time to keep the franchise from floating to another city. Again, Bill Veeck made it fun to be at the ballpark on Chicago's South Side. Veeck's philosophy? Create the greatest enjoyment for the greatest number of people. In 1977, although finishing 12 games out of first, the White Sox won 90 games and set their all-time attendance record, almost 1,700,000 fans. A Veeck favorite, a Veeck trademark, was the exploding scoreboard, which he introduced in 1960. Another Veeck specialty, unique uniforms, one set even featuring short pants. But as baseball uniforms changed, so did the game's monetary structure.
It isn't really the stars that are expensive. It's the high cost of mediocrity.
On August 22nd, the high cost of mediocrity had the White Sox $3 million in debt. The man who insisted that everyone call him by his first name sold the team for $20 million. Charles Oscar Finley entered baseball with no sports background. As an insurance man who had long tried to buy a ball club, Finley entered the field in 1960 with the struggling Kansas City A's. In 68, the team moved to Oakland and there struck up a winning combo. Although as stubborn as his mule, Charlie O, Finley turned his A's into a powerhouse. He even paid his players to grow mustaches. He furnished them with multicolored uniforms. Other teams quickly followed suit. Finley was an early proponent of the orange baseball, the designated hitter, and the World Series to be played under the lights. He hired 18 managers in 20 years and hired three men twice. But despite such turmoil, his A's won five straight divisional titles and three straight World Series. The team began to crumble in 75. The glory days were over. Catfish Hunter had found a loophole in his contract, and he was declared a free agent. The exodus of stars had just begun. Charlie Finley simply couldn't cope with free agency and the new era of big spenders.
It looked to me, reminded me of a den of thieves out to cut one another's throat.
In 1979, the A's drew only 300,000 fans and lost 108 games, every which way. Despite this year's revival by Billy Martin, on August 23rd, one day after the sale of the White Sox, Charles O. Finley sold the A's for $12.7 million. And as we say goodbye to Charlie and Bill, we note that the sale of the White Sox comes up for approval on Friday. Game 6 coming up just moments away. It'll be Steve Carlton for the Phillies going against Rich Gale for the Royals. Tony, Joe, and Tom will have first pitch right after this update from NBC News.
This evening from Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia, NBC Sports presents Game 6 of the 1980 World Series. The American League champions, the Kansas City Royals, versus the National League champions, the Philadelphia Phillies. Brought to you by Light Beer, everything you always wanted in a beer and less. By Gillette Track 2, to guys who use a twin-blade Gillette Track 2, no other blade will do. By Ford and your local Ford dealer, who invite you to test drive the new 1981 Ford cars and trucks. And by Pepsi Cola and your local Pepsi Cola bottler, who invite you to catch that Pepsi spirit. Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia. A beautiful night for baseball, 60 degrees, and these Philly fans are really ready, as I'm sure you can hear in the background. Hi, everybody. I'm Joe Garagiola, and we're getting ready for Game 6. We're going to have over 65,000 cheering fans here in Philadelphia. They're expecting the kind of a game they've been watching throughout this series, a series that has seen either ball club going to the ninth inning with a chance to win. The Royals, they're capable of winning here in Philadelphia, as capable as the Phillies were winning in Kansas City to bring it back 3-2. Royals fans are asking, can the Royals win? The Phillies fans, when they're not cheering, are saying, how soon will the Phillies fall behind so they can catch up and win? Tom Seaver is with a man who makes his Philly outfit go, according to many. Let's go to Tom.
Thank you, Joe. Pete Paulowns, your general manager, said that you were the one player to push this team over the top. And you watched the Phillies play for many years when you were with the Cincinnati Reds. What is it that they needed? What is it you brought to this ball club to push them over the top?
Well, first of all, Tom, when I came to Philadelphia, I don't think because I had 3,000 hits or made many all-star games or got 200 hits many times that I was going to be a team leader, because I think team leadership comes from respect from your peers, from watching you play on a daily basis. And last year I had a lot of adversity off the field, and I played hard 162 games long. And this year I played hard 163 games long. And I just think the players could see how I could concentrate on their different things and play hard day in and day out. And I think that rubbed off on some of my teammates. I think, if anything, this ball club lacked, I know when we played them in 76, they had a lead against us in a couple of the games in the playoffs, and they just lacked that killer instinct. And, you know, there's no tomorrow in the playoffs, and I really emphasize the pressure in the playoffs, how important the playoffs are, and how much fun the World Series should be. I think these guys have listened to everything that I've said, and they've done a great job so far.
You lead on the field, the guy in the dugout, Dallas Green, has had his ups and downs with his players, but he's gotten you one game from a world championship.
Well, I think he should be manager of the year. I think the problems he's had, Tom, is simply he's a very, very much of a disciplinarian. And I think the guy they had before him, Danny Ozark, who was very successful, wasn't quite the disciplinarian that Dallas is. And some of the guys resented that. But I think Dallas has got through to the guys that he had to get through to in 1980.
Thanks, Pete. Good luck tonight.
Thank you, Tom.
All right, let's go over to Tony Kubek, who has Frank Wright with him.
All right, thank you, Tom. Frank, you are not sitting in what you would call an ideal situation. Coming into Philadelphia, you have to win two ball games. What is the attitude of the ball club?
Well, I think the ball club basically is just looking at it as a challenge. I think we're trying to use coming into Philadelphia, being a game down and having to win two ball games, we're trying to use that as a challenge for the ball club to get up for tonight's ball game.
You're facing a man, a left-hander, probably will be the Cy Young Award winner of the National League, Steve Carlton. Many people in the National League, and in this town especially, feel he is invincible. What do you think?
Well, no pitcher's invincible. We faced him here earlier in the series, and we had a lot of opportunities. We didn't know him that well, and he had a lot of control problems. He blamed it on the balls being too slick, so I'm just waiting to see him tonight, and I believe that our hitters can hit anybody, and it's just a matter of whether we can keep the Phillies from scoring.
All right, Frank, thank you so much. Back upstairs now to Joe Garagiola.
Okay, Tony, the pitching, the rotation, find Steve Carlton, the number one pitcher for the Phillies. He's working tonight. In the rotation, Rich Gale is number three. He's pitching tonight. Does it make a difference? I believe what Mike Schmidt said. The only difference is we have it tomorrow. The Royals do not. We'll find out. Let's go to the PA announcer and our national anthem.
As country and western and former Major League Baseball player Charlie Pride honors America by singing our national anthem.
They're queuing him down.
At the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we walked, were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets rippled, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner get way o'er the land of the free and the home of the free?
Charlie Pride, who played baseball, loves baseball, with our national anthem. Some 65,000 people here. The stage is set. We'll be back with the first pitch of Game 6 right after these messages. Gale against Carlton. Should be a great night. Veterans Stadium, Game 6. The stage is set, and we're ready for our ceremonial first pitch. Let's go to first base.
Attention to the VIP box. on the right field side of the Phillies dugout, where the ceremonial first pitch will be thrown out by a symbol of Phillies baseball for 20 years. He's among the Phillies career leaders in games played, at-bats, hits, and stolen bases. Tony Taylor.
Here's the defense the Philadelphia Phillies will have behind Carlton tonight. Lonnie Smith in left, Gary Maddox in center, Bake McBride in right field, Mike Schmidt in third, Larry Bowe at short, Manny Trio, the second baseman, Pete Rose at first. Bob Boone has really caught a great series thus far, and the man on the mound is Steve Carlton. Right now, we'll have Joe Garagiola give you the starting lineup for the Kansas City Royals, the one that will face Carlton tonight.
Here is the lineup for the Kansas City Royals. Leading off, Willie Wilson in left field. Batting second, the shortstop, UL Washington. Batting third at third base, George Brett. In the cleanup spot, designated hitter, Hal McRae. Amos Otis bats fifth, he's in center field. Willie Akins at first base, batting sixth. Batting seventh, the catcher, John Wathan. Batting eighth, the right fielder, Jose Cardenal. And batting ninth, the second baseman, Frank White.
Tom, Steve Carlton, even George Brett in the interview talked about he couldn't get his breaking ball over. What are you looking for tonight?
Well, you're going to look more of the same for Steve Carlton, a big, powerful pitcher, Joe. The trouble that Steve Carlton had in game two, I think, and he said after the game, the slickness of the baseball, the shininess of the baseball prevented him from throwing his real good breaking ball. I think the thing tonight, looking at Steve, of course, 24-9 on the year, probably the Cy Young Award winner in the National League this year. The thing to remember about him is that counting spring training, the league championship series, the regular season, everything all combined, he's already thrown over 350 innings. So you might see a tired Steve Carlton tonight. He was tired in game two.
One strike to count. Strike two. Wilson has already struck out nine times in five games, close to a record. One ball, two strikes, a jam-packed ballpark, and this town has just been waiting for their Philadelphia Phillies. They are really up. Struck him out 10 times out on strikes, Willie Wilson. A six-game series, Jim Bottomley had the record at 9, but here it is again.
You may see a Steve Carlton tonight, 350 innings all year long, but one thing to remember is that he's got an extra day's rest. This is his sixth day that he's pitching. That extra day's rest could give a pitcher a little bit of pop, and he certainly looks like he's throwing very hard. He did to Willie Wilson, the first hitter up.
Here's UL Washington, and once again, early in the game, you see that toothpick, and you youngsters, it's all right for UL Washington, but that's one thing. Please don't copy. He can do it. You really can't. Strike one. It's dangerous.
Carlton looks fast tonight. He turned one ball over to Wilson on the outside corner, but he's thrown nothing but heat.
One out, one strikeout, second batter, UL Washington, Carlton. One ball, one strike, one out. Behind the plate, Nick Bremigan.
He has one of the most strenuous conditioning programs under the tutelage of Gus Heffling that I have ever seen, and he feels that he can bounce back a little bit faster than most guys under this program.
2-2, the count of fastball on UL Washington, one out, nobody on.
Tony, there's no question, he knows that it helps him, and he works very hard at it. The only thing that is concerning tonight would be a concern tonight that he does have all those innings, 350 innings. Is an awful lot of innings for a starting pitcher to pitch in this era.
Misses. Full count, 3 balls, 2 strikes. 1980, pitched 304 innings, the most in the major leagues. Gave up most hits and most strikeouts he had. 243 hits, 286 strikeouts. Work hard. Fouled out of play. Count remains. For about the first half of this baseball season, every time Carlton went out to the mound, he looked like he was unhittable. He had all four pitches going for him. Hard fastball, the curveball, slide. He even started to throw a little bit of a changeup late in the season. Two pitch. UL Washington making him work. Count remains 3-2. The on deck batter, George Brett. How do you pitch him? Well, we got all kinds of answers. Struck him out.
Well, Joe, you just asked the question, how do you pitch George Brett? We went to one of the closest members of his family, his brother, and asked Kenny, a pitcher on this team, how you pitch to George?
Mm-hmm. Well, I faced my brother George once in spring training, the first time I ever did, and he hit a ball about 430 feet off me. I've been scared to pitch to him ever since then. So what I'm going to suggest the Phillies do is, first of all, take off your shoe and throw this at him. It doesn't hit shoes too well. If that doesn't work, throw your glove at him. This is a first baseman's glove. He doesn't like to hit first baseman's glove. And last thing I would suggest is put the glove back on your hand, sneak behind the mound, put the rosin bag in your glove, and pretend like it's a baseball. Throw the rosin bag at him, and hopefully don't hurt him.
It's a different way of pitching him. Ken Brett, his brother. And George doesn't get the first one, strike one.
He's been a little mini slump since the knockdown incident. He's 1-8.
Strike two. Steve Carlton working in a hurry. He is firing, rearing back, and firing. He has struck out the first two batters. Two strikes, no balls. George Brett. Booney looking for a waste pitch, picks it off nicely. 1-2. Tony referred to it. Boone has had a tremendous series.
He is picking balls out of the dirt, Joe. It's just been unbelievable this entire series, especially with the kid pitchers who pitch.
Bouncing ball, Trio to his right has it in time. So it's 3-3 for the Kansas City Royals. Bottom of the first, no score. It'll be Smith, Rose, and Schmidt for the Phillies. And for the Philadelphia Phillies, Lonnie Smith in left field leads off. Batting second, the first baseman, Pete Rose. Batting third, Mike Schmidt, third base. In the cleanup spot, Meg McBride, right field. Greg Luzinski batting fifth, the DH. Gary Maddox in center field. Batting seventh, Manny Trio, the second baseman. Batting eighth, Larry Boa, the shortstop. And batting ninth, the catcher, Bob Boone.
And here's the Royals defense. Willie Wilson left. Amos Otis in center. Jose Cardenal out in right today. George Brett at third. UL Washington at short. Frank White, the second baseman. Willie Mays Akins at first. John Wathan is catching today. And it's Rich Gale who is in the second World Series game.
Rich Gale, big 6'7", 225-pound right-handed pitcher, 26 years old. He pitched in game number 3 for the Royals. Pitched 4 1/3 innings. About 2 runs on 7 hits. He walked 3 and struck out 3. You'll see a power pitcher, what the Phillies like to describe, more like a pitcher they would normally see in the National League. Good hard fastball, good slider. Dr. Billy Connors, the pitching coach, he said his instructions are, Rich Gale, tonight go out there and give it your best, whether it's 1 inning, 2 innings, 3 innings, 4 innings. Go as hard and as hard as long as you possibly can. That's what they want from Rich Gale tonight.
There you see the dimensions here in this ballpark. A park a little bit unlike Royal Stadium. This park, the ball flies on a little bit better. I got to believe the key, Joe, for Gale today, if he's going to have a good outing or a good 5-6 innings, can he get his curveball over? He gets his curveball over, they can't sit on that fastball.
You've got to have the pitch they're looking for and the one to cross him up. Here is Lonnie Smith. Smith has been in 5 games. Been to bat 15 times with 4 hits. He struck out once, walked once, hitting 267. Strike one.
I like this kid as an offensive player. He has tremendous speed when he does get on base. He has a good quick bat. He spent his time in the minor leagues. They were afraid of his defense. Or offensively, he can hurt you.
One strike pitch. It's high Fry, 1-1. I heard Jim Fry talking and answering questions about the crowd as far as the intimidation of his team. 1-1 pitch. It's down the right field line. It is foul ball. Tom, I want to ask you, as a pitcher, is it an individual thing? Can you turn it off? But a crowd like this, 65,000, is it a factor?
I think it's a factor, Joe, for a younger pitcher like Gale. Young kid just getting his feet on the ground. He's 26 years old, but for experience, he's a young pitcher, not like a Steve Carlton, who seems to be able to block everything out. I think the older you get, the more time you spend in the big leagues, you're able to control all the outside things that go on around the ballpark.
I've seen young pitchers just be caused to overthrow. I just wonder if that's it. 1-2 pitch is fouled out of play, if that's the only thing.
Well, when you have the dimension of pitching away, World Series, a deciding game for Kansas City, they do have no tomorrow. If they don't lose today, they go home. There's a lot of pressure on that young pitcher out there.
Rich Gale. It's one ball, two strikes, nobody out, nobody on. We're in the bottom of the first. Frank White, these two second basemen have just been something. Frank White has been amazing. Manny Trio, both of them. Trio with his relay throws, White with the glove.
Joe, this is just a routine play, but both White and Boas said before the series, the team that makes all the routine plays will have a better defensive series. It's not just at second base, it's throughout the middle of the diamond. Boas, not missed a play yet. He's made them all. And UL Washington's made some good plays.
Here is Pete Rose. Rose hitting 158. 3-for-19. Didn't mean to swing. It's a base hit. Rose is on with a single. And it'll bring up Mike Schmidt, who'll get a tremendous hand from this crowd.
Here comes from left center field, a check swing. Slider, a cut fastball. One of those oops. And I'll tell you one thing. Wilson better not do that too often on Rose. Go down on one knee and just take his time. Because Pete will keep going.
Mike Schmidt. Schmidt is 7-for-18. He has scored 6 runs, hitting 389. 2 home runs, 5 runs batted in. Job to try to pick in this World Series. There are so many candidates. One of them in a batter's box right here, Mike Schmidt. Outside. Ball one.
You know, Joe, I was on the elevator today. Somebody said, boy, Schmidt has a good night tonight. He'll wrap up the most valuable player in the National League. But a lot of people don't know it, that votes for the most valuable player in the leagues have to be in before the start of postseason play. What they do in the championship series or World Series has no bearing on the most valuable player vote.
Ball, no strikes. Rose at first. One man out, no score. Two balls and no strikes.
Sent back for one thing. Fastball from Gale. I recall his last outing. He didn't throw that breaking pitch when he's behind at all. That gives that hitter a little bit of an advantage.
Notice the eye, runner eye. There's a definite rhythm set up by Gale before he even goes into his stretch. Foul back. Watch it once again with Rose on, who really is not that big a base stealing threat, especially with Schmidt hitting. You'll see the rhythm develop. Our technical crew has picked it up already. High runner. Taking more time, breaking the stride. Mike Schmidt doesn't get a good pitch on the outside corner. Look like a slider. Two balls, two strikes, one out.
A couple of pitches to Schmidt. Gale's fastball looked very alive. Schmidt on 2-1 was looking for a fastball. It was a perfect spot down and away, but it had some movement on it.
Popped up. UL Washington and Frank White. UL Washington says, I'll take it. So there are two away. And it brings up Bake McBride. McBride has hit one home run. That was a three-run homer. He's driven in four, hitting 368, 7-for-19. Rose at first, two outs, no score.
That is Harry Wendelstedt, the first base umpire today.
Hal McRae leads it off, hitting at 450, 9 base hits, 20 times at bat. He has 3 doubles. 2 of them were literally singles that he just stretched into doubles by aggressive base running. Hal McRae. They play him towards the right field line. And he pops the first pitch up. Trio, McBride. McBride says, I'll take it. One out.
Well, Joe, you set up here for 5 games in the World Series, and I know you've admired Bob Boone, the catcher. He's kept caught walk, Bystrom, 2 rookies. We asked him about Carlton and what he has to do tonight.
Steve Carlton tonight has got to pitch his game. We won't do anything special to any of the Kansas City players. He's got to have his good slider. If he has that, he'll give us an outstanding effort. If he doesn't have it, he'll give us a fine effort, and we know we'll be in the ballgame.
He's either going to be great and beat him, or he's going to be just less than great and beat him, I guess. But they say about the last 10 times he's been out, Carlton, he really hasn't had his great stuff. Early in the year, he just overpowered everyone.
He's got his good slider. He'll win. If he doesn't, he'll keep us close. What a tribute. Here is Amos Otis. Otis hitting at 550. There's the strike. Otis has been to bat 20 times. He has 11 base hits. He has scored 4 runs. 2 doubles, 3 home runs, 7 runs batted in. He didn't like the call by Bremigan.
Well, Carlton, the last time out in this World Series against Kansas City, he had a lot of base runners, a lot of chances off him, but he got the double play 3 times when he needed it and got the strikeouts when he needed it with men on base. He seems to be able to reach back and come up with that big pitch.
Strike 2. And Otis is upset again.
Tom, he looks like he's got a good fastball tonight. That ball is really tailing away from right-handed hitters. The first ball game, a lot of his fastballs when he was tired were running high and away and out of the strike zone.
He looks like he's throwing awfully hard, Tony. There's no question about it. It looks like he's throwing harder than he was in game 2.
He's keeping the ball down, too.
Certainly the extra day's rest, pitching here on the 6th day, could definitely be a factor.
Count remains at strike 2. Otis, with his 11 base hits, is the on-deck batter is Willie Akins. Otis is one hit short of tying a record for a 6-game series, Billy Martin's record, 1953, when Billy had 12 base hits in the 6-game series. Otis, one short. Outside. 1-2. Been much said about Carlton's refusal to talk to the press. I'll tell you, it's a decision he made. It's certainly his right to do it, and he just doesn't want to do it. He's turned down tremendous amounts of money. Just doesn't want to do it. 2-2.
He's had a policy, and he's kept consistent at it for 7 years. He just doesn't talk to writers, broadcasters.
He doesn't change it. That's the way he wants to do it. It's his right. It is his business. And in fact, I've been reading about how arrogant the Phillies have been. I must say, to a man, they've been great. Anything we've asked, they've been there. Just wonder if sometimes it isn't a personal thing. Otis trying to set his pace. Carlton says, I'll set my pace. And here we go. 2-2 pitch. Fouled off again.
I'm a little surprised, Tony, with this pitching pattern. The base hits that Amos Otis has been getting have been the last game where the breaking balls, the off-speed pitches, the home run he hit was an off-speed pitch. The single he got was an off-speed pitch.
and they've been pitches that have usually been bad pitches. Hanging curveballs, a hanging slider one time.
There's that 55-footer, the same one he threw the other night.
I found it interesting, Joe. You can play around with numbers so far through the five games. There's the breaking ball. Maybe he overthrew it. Trying for the strikeout. Like a curveball rather than a slider.
Many times you try and overthrow a breaking ball, make it too good instead of just letting it do what it's supposed to do, and you end up throwing it right in the dirt. It's been such an effective pitch, that slider for him, and he uses it an awful lot to right-hand hitters. It'll be interesting here to see if he uses the slider or the fastball.
Something off it.
Foul tip.
Started to say about numbers, the Kansas City Royals Ball Club is supposed to be the team that pecks away at you and keeps the ball in play. They have struck out 40 times through the first five games. That's an average of 8 strikeouts a game. The Phillies, on the other hand, presumably a more power ball club, but they've struck out just 14 times through the first five games. So it might give you an indication of the differences in pitching staffs in the two leagues. Yes, there are more power pitchers. I think this might prove in the National League than the American League. More hard throwers.
We've got a cat and mouse game going on between Otis and Carlton. Ball four, drew the base on balls. So Otis is on. I tell you, you get the feeling that was the Amos Otis hour. The foul tips and foul balls and backing out. First base runner for the Kansas City Royals. Here's Willie Aiken.
And I got to believe that Jim Fry, having his club coming to this away town in this critical situation, has got to stir his team up. Even though Carlton has a good move, I got to believe he's got to try and run somebody, because around that batting cage today, they were a very somber group. They know what they're up against here, winning two in Philadelphia. And even with Aikens up, I wouldn't doubt one bit. And with Carlton's great move, they try and start somebody.
Holding. Ball one.
Carlton set a major league record for balks with 11 a year or so ago. Very tricky move.
There it is. He's back. Otis is checking with Wendelstedt. We have an American League umpire back there now, so we got that. Is it a balk or not a balk? Otis is talking to his first base coach. How about it, Ronnie? Has he got an edge tonight? Ron Luciano? We didn't hear you, Ron.
I said it's awful close to a balk, that first one. It has to come directly towards the base. And that looked like it went almost towards home. And so that's what Otis went over and talked to Harry Wendelstedt about. He said, hey, boy, that's awful close to being a balk. Watch that.
Ronnie, what Jose Martinez was talking about in the first game he pitched, he's the first base coach, Martinez, that Carlton would stop his motion. When he picked his right leg off the ground, he would stop and try and freeze the runner. And then he would go homer first.
There's a strike. Two balls and one strike. Wendelstedt at first base really bearing down on Carlton. He is the umpire.
That pitch there, Joe, is something we haven't seen much in the World Series. Carlton was behind, two balls and no strikes. Almost invariably, probably 90% of the time when the pitchers in this World Series have gotten behind, they've thrown fastballs. Carlton there was 2-0 and threw the breaking ball.
Oh, that was close. He was leaning, jumping around, and Carlton about had him.
Well, you heard Ron say he's supposed, the rule says step directly toward the plate or directly toward the bag, but pitchers bend the rules. Watch where he steps. They pick a spot halfway between home plate and first base, and then they continue walking to deceive the umpire and the base dealer.
Ron Luciano, how can they get away from that? Weren't you guys talking about putting a line on a mound at one time?
2 years ago, they put a line in there, but it worked too well. It was too easy to call. They wanted the controversy, and so they took the line out.
Well, they got it. Two balls, two strikes. Willie Aikens. We're in the top of the second inning. There is no score. One man out. Amos Otis drew a base on balls. Curveball misses. The pitcher didn't snap off. That just seemed to roll and hang. Three balls, two strikes. Now we'll find out if Jim Fry's running his ball club. Aikens is a strikeout man. Otis can run, so it could be a strike him out, throw him out. I would think he'd be running. There he goes. Ball four. So Otis is on his second, and Boone doesn't believe it. Now they're going to ask the umpire third.
Boone has the appeal. Down to the third base umpire, Paul Pryor, who waved the safe sign. Boone wasn't sure. He didn't get a very quick call, so he kind of took the glove out. The ball.
Curveball blocked nicely by Bob Boone as John Wotham takes it for ball one. Time is called. Nice play by Boone again. When the left-hander throws a curveball, you really have to get your body just at the edge of it because it breaks back when it hits the ground because of the spin. It's a tough play, and Boone has been making it well.
Carlton and Rose have a play at first base in a situation like this. If Aiken gets too far, they've got to watch out.
Ball two. Carlton gave up six walks but struck out 10 in game two. He's walked two and struck out two so far tonight. There's a strike.
There's another example, Joe, of being behind Gordy McKenzie at third base, coach for the Royals. Carlton was behind and came back with a breaking ball.
Wathan looking for his first base hit. He's been to bat only four times in this series. Fouled out of play. Two balls, two strikes. One out. The on-deck batter is Jose Cardenal. He's playing right field. Fry wanted to get some right-handed bats, and he got one in, and Cardenal, you see right there, the on-deck batter in right field, and John Wotham behind the plate. Otis at second. Akins is at first. One out. Double play ball. Boa, one. Cinch, two. 6-4-3. That ends the inning. And so we go into the bottom half of the second inning. It's Kansas City nothing, Philadelphia nothing, and these fans are really fired up as Steve Carlton goes walking off a nothing-nothing ball game here in the second inning, game number six.
There are six or seven times in a ball game when a pitcher has to make a pitch to stop a rally or keep the other team from scoring. Here's the first one for Carlton. He makes the pitch on Wotham. The double play, 6-4-3, and the Phillies are out of the inning.
Here is Greg Luzinski to lead it off here in the second inning. Luzinski's been to bat five times looking for his first hit. Takes the pitch outside, and it's ball one. Out of play, one and one.
Luzinski said that between at bats when he's DHing, he'll go up in the runway, run up and down the hall. He'll swing a bat with a leaded weight on it. He'll watch the TV screen in there and try and pick up pitches and patterns to other right-handed hitters.
Two strikes, one ball, no outs, nobody on. Rich Gale. Out of play. Gale started game three in Kansas City. He worked four and a third innings, gave up seven hits, two earned runs, three walks, three strikeouts. Breaking ball just misses outside. Two balls and two strikes. Outside, full count, three and two now. The on-deck batter is Gary Maddox, followed by Manny Trio. There's the on-deck man, Gary Maddox. He's been a first ball hitter throughout this season. Foul back by Luzinski, he had a good cut.
That's the Bulls pitch. Fastball down, a little bit inside part of the plate. And you can see his disgust when he missed it. He was on it, so apparently Gale's ball, like Carlton's, is pretty lively. Right there. The Bull may have been a little bit late, but that is his zone.
Struck him out. Luzinski out on strikes. One out in the bottom half of the second inning.
One of the good things that can happen to a pitcher when you run to a three and two count, and the hitter knows what's coming. Sometimes the hitter will swing at a bad pitch, And there's a case Luzinski knew was fastball. It was out of the strike zone, but he still went after him.
Didn't get his strike one. It's usually the high fastball because that ball really looks big. Low ball, you really only see the top half of the ball. High pitch, you see it all. Miss it all, too. That's in the gap in right center field. It'll be extra bases for Maddox. Otis cuts it off. It's a stand-up double for Maddox.
They were shading him a little bit toward right center field. A breaking ball, almost a perfect pitch. Down low and away. Slider curveball. Otis right here by getting to this ball in a hurry may have prevented a triple. Boy, this is what that speed, how important it is, not just on the bases, but defensively. The Royals have built their team on that speed. Frank White, he is up throwing on the relay.
Maddox is on its second. That's his fourth base hit of the series, his second double. There's one man out. Here is Manny Trio, who is 5-for-19. Right field. Cardinal back, tagging up is Maddox at second base. He's going to go to third. He'll make it easily. Two outs, and it brings up Larry Boa.
Good bunter, as we've said before throughout this series, and so Brett and Akins at first will have to watch the bunt because Bo will try anything he can to score this run.
Bo is 8-for-20. He has driven in two runs. That's a 400 average. Bo is hitting 400. Boone's hitting 400. Last three men in the Kansas City lineup are no average, and 95. Makes a difference. Wilson really shallow in left field. Fastball is outside, ball one. Look at that defense near the line. Otis is way over. If Boa hits a line drive over the pitcher's head, he may run for about maybe 8 or 9 days.
Or in that right field corner if he pulls the ball.
Down the left field line. It is one ball and one strike. Here's where the responsibility really goes on the pitcher. If you expect him to hit that way, you better pitch him that way.
I was thinking the same thing, Joe. If he throws a curveball
or a changeup
here and gives him something to pull, that pitching coach will come out of that dugout so fast and make your head turn.
If the catcher hasn't turned it already with a bat. Popped up. Foul territory. Wathan coming back. Has room. He makes the catch in front of the dugout. So Boa is out, fouls out to the catcher at the end of two complete innings of score here. Kansas City nothing, Philadelphia nothing. And in the third inning for the Kansas City Royals, it will be Jose Cardinal, Frank White, and Willie Wilson. And we'll be back after these messages from your local station. Jose Cardinal will lead it off here in the third inning. Cardinal has been to bat six times, looking for his first base hit. He's a free swinger. Breaking ball misses. Check the ball, says Cardinal. It hit the dirt. And it's ball one. Well hit. Left field. Lonnie Smith is back. He has room. One out.
Tom, from what we've seen so far, it still does not appear, and it's early, that Kauffman has found his curveball. He's bounced his curveball quite a bit. He's got his fastball going for him, I think. He's got the fastball low in the strike zone.
I think he came out, Tony, he came out and threw 10 fastballs in a row. And the second inning, he started to throw his breaking ball, slider, curveball, tried to establish to get that over. Came out through 10 fastballs in a row, struck the first two hitters out, and then started throwing breaking balls. And throwing extremely hard, too.
White doesn't get a strike one. White in the bat 21 times, two base hits. Read in the paper his mother didn't come to Philadelphia. She's home watching because she doesn't like to fly airplanes. So she's watching Frank, who grew up in the shadows of the old ballpark in Kansas City.
One ball, one strike.
She's watching Frank like we all are. All baseball fans put on quite a show with his glove.
Oh, brother.
There's the strike. Tom, let me get back to again to that fastball. And as you said, he started out and established the fastball. That curve is more of a field pitch, isn't it?
The curveball is a field pitch that you have to establish, and that's Carlton's bread and butter pitch right there, that slider. It looks like it's going to be a way outside of the right hitter, and all of a sudden breaks down and in on his knees.
Popped out of play. Two balls and two strikes to count on Frank White.
If he can get that slider over, with as hard as he's throwing his fastball tonight, it could be a long inning for Kansas City, because this man, you look at Willie Wilson, Carlton can be as tough as any pitcher in baseball. It's going to be the Cy Young Award winner of the National League, in my opinion.
Foul back.
He's already got two of those with the Phillies.
Carlton was having problems with the baseball because they were slick and they weren't rubbed up by the proper mud from the Burlington County waters, I have learned. I've learned all kinds of things about that mud. Out on strikes. That is the third strikeout for Carlton. For example, we thought there was big inflation. We were wrong. As we look at this replay, it's a curveball and White is completely fooled on it. That mud does not cost $100 a can. In 1938, it cost $10, only cost $15 right now if you can buy it. Here's Willie Wilson. Wilson has had a tough series in the batter's box, but he's played well in the field. Strike two. He has struck out 10 times. Record for a six-game series was 9 strikeouts by Jim Bottomley in 1930. Should this series end, Willie Wilson would have the dubious distinction. He is out on strikes. 7-game series. It's 11 strikeouts, so if it goes 7 games, he's got it tied right now. So that ends the third inning. We go into the bottom half of the third inning. There is no score here. Kansas City nothing, Philadelphia nothing. And for the Phillies, Bob Boone, Smith, and Rose. Joe Garagiola with Tony Kubek and Tom Seaver here in Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia. Nothing, nothing, bottom of the third. Bob Boone will lead it off. And Boone has been to bat 15 times, has 6 hits. He's walked 3 times, has 2 doubles, hitting at 400. Bob Boone.
Did you see his father, Ray, out here very early today, what he was doing? Playing, Ray, of course, a former major leaguer, playing Pepper with his grandchildren, Aaron and Brett.
Man, I can't wait to
see that myself. That's coming up pretty quickly, isn't it?
I can't wait, I'll tell you that. He was really thrilled, Ray Boone, former major leaguer. There's a good fastball. Talking about Carlton throwing hard, Gale is throwing hard, and it's ball one. And it's ball two. Wathan behind the plate doesn't agree.
He's shaking his head and not turning all the way, but he is on hold plate up our Nick Bremigan a little bit.
You can usually talk to the umpires as long as you keep looking towards the outfield and not turn around and show them up. Ball four. Hey, Ron Luciano, when catchers would turn around, you're one of the few guys that let them turn around to talk to you. You just wanted to visit, huh?
I'd let anybody talk to me. Nah, you don't let them turn around on you. That's a cardinal sin. They can call you any name under the sun as long as they're looking out towards center field, because only you and he know what he's talking or who he's talking about. But as soon as he turns around, that's an automatic ejection. Good night. See you tomorrow.
If he turns around, he's embarrassing the umpire. That's one thing they cannot stand. They have to show their authority, and they do. Here's Lonnie Smith. Frank White has it. He goes to UL Washington, gets the fourth. Save! Now Otto, I don't know what he's doing. Time. He calls save and then time. Bill Kunkel, here comes Jim Frey.
Well, Frank White had one thing in mind. Get the lead runner. UL Washington cheated. He was off the bag. The second base up
umpire, Bill Kunkel, said, yes, you did cheat too much, and I'm going to call him safe. Watch it. A different angle. I'll tell you, he's off that bag by a little bit more than a couple of inches, probably a foot and a half or so, and it cost him. Bill Washington was trying to get out of the way of the hard sliding Boone, and by trying to do, he wasn't trying to get a throw off, by trying to do so, he cheated too much. I think Kunkel made the right call.
Bill Kunkel had his right hand up. Look, maybe he called him out, but he was calling time. And so we've got base runners at first and second. I really couldn't tell on that play, Tony, to tell you the truth. So it looked like he was just in the neighborhood. Here's another look at it. Let's see.
This left center field camera should be the excellent angle.
Oh, he was safe.
His foot
was off, yeah.
You know, you get away with a little bit of that, and many times umpires will give you that call. But that was a little too obvious.
It's an error on the shortstop, UL Washington.
Here it is again, Tommy.
I don't understand how they can give an error to the shortstop on the ball, first of all.
Well, I don't,
Tony.
You think he was drawn off by the throw?
It looks like he was drawn off by the throw, definitely. There's no play at first base. There's no way you're going to double up Lonnie Smith.
Right. What Washington's got to do then, if he's drawn off because he's got plenty of time, is get the ball first and then come back and tag the bag. You've got to get one out.
So there is nobody out. Base runners at first and second. The infield looking for the bunt at first and third. Pete Rose, the batter. He had a base hit his first time up. There's no score in the third. They've got the play on, and Rose takes it high. And what I mean by the play is the shortstop goes to third. Tony, you've worked that play.
Well, ordinarily, first and second, what you'll do is the third baseman will come in and make sure the hitter commits himself. The shortstop will go to second, second baseman to first, first baseman charges. This particular play, they have Washington, here he comes, going to third, White going to second. Well, one of the reasons they'll do that is because they've got a slower runner at second base. You try it on a fast runner, and he's going to beat the shortstop there, and you're in big trouble.
There they go again, the pitch is low. One thing you have to do is make them bunt the ball, and now Watham wants to talk to Gale. Boone, a good base runner, although he may be slow, is not getting in no man's land so he could pick off like UL Washington as Billy Connors comes out to the mound to talk to the young pitcher.
Tom, they must have heard you because they have changed the official scorer's decision to E4. Frank White for pulling UL Washington off the bag. Now Green is having a conference with a home plate umpire as Green talking to Bremigan. Here's Akins coming in from first base. Nobody is covering first base on this particular play. They may change, as Dallas Green may change too. I don't know what he's talking about. If someone is getting in the way of one of his base runners, he may be saying that UL Washington is getting in the way of Boone. We'll find out.
Well, Harry Wendelstedt, they're going to go over and talk to Dallas Green now. I don't know if it's an American League or National League or whatever. Bremigan's from the American League. He brought in Wendelstedt. Ronnie, Luciano, you got any idea what's going on?
Well, I know there's a rule in the American League that you can't have, you only can have one infielder and a coach on the mound at the same time. That time they had two infielders on, and what I think Green is saying is, hey, is this legal? Can I get a balk out of it or eject the pitcher or something like that?
You've got
to
be
many,
kidding.
No, I'm
the World Series are going to go to that? Park.
You're only allowed the catcher, one infielder, and a manager on the mound.
That's the American League. We're in the National League.
But they're playing under that rule today.
Right. That's like blaming the Johnstown flood on a leaky faucet, for crying out loud. Here's the pitch to Rose. It's a foul ball out of play.
And Boone was running off second base that time. They had, well, almost the whole field open. Brett and Akins charging. Both short and second base were wide open.
Tony, it was much more serious than that. They wanted to know if Fry spoke to his pitcher, which would count as a trip to the plate. So, Luciano, you were pretty close. Ah, World Series. Let's make that mountain out of the molehill. Two balls, one strike, nobody out. Pete Rose with base runners at first and second. No score. Listen to this crowd. High. 3-1.
Let me tell you what might happen to Gale. He's had a streak of control problems there, obviously, but with all the things going on behind him, He, I believe, is so distracted that if they do bunt to me, where in the world do I throw the ball? If Pete bunts it, do I go to third? Is somebody going to be there? Is anybody going to be on first? I believe these plays can really goof a guy up.
Trick plays will kill you. All they can do is signal for a fair catch, for crying out loud.
Rattle Gale.
3-1 pitch. Bunt it down to third base. It's going to be a hit. Rose is charging hard. Brett's safe.
They put a little more pressure on the kid pitcher Gale than ought to have been. Rose does make a perfect bunt. Gale froze on the mound. Here comes Brett. Rose beats it out.
Tony, I can't help, but the concentration on Rose's eyes on that last replay, he was going to make sure he bunted the ball on the ground, and as you say, they just thought themselves into a base hit, the Kansas City defense.
Gale made a mental mistake in game number two. As you remember, Tony, the ball hit back to him with the bases loaded. He didn't go home. He went to first base. Here again, he's made a mental mistake on that bunt play. The pitcher's job on this play is to break right toward the third baseline. You don't go toward home plate. That's the pitcher's ball right there. That is not George Brett's responsibility. The pitcher should make that play.
Well, Kansas City has already given Philadelphia two outs this inning.
And there are nobody out. Bases are loaded, and Mike Schmidt, their big man in the batter's box. The little bunt does it again. High, ball one. A walk to Boone. An error by White. A bunt by Rose. And Gale faces the bases loaded with Mike Schmidt, the batter. Nobody out. Out of play. Pete Rose, who had only four sacrifice bunts all year, and what a classic bunt that was, got that bat out in front, much like the instructions. Catch the ball on the bat, and anyone can bunt. And Rose ends up with a base hit. Sheer hustle after he got his job done, which was bunting the ball towards third. Base hit, right field. Here comes one run in. Smith is going to score. Heading for third is Rose. Smith stumbles, and now he finally comes across. He was late coming around. He fell again, and it's a 2-0 ball game.
Fastball out over the plate. A little bit down. Schmidt really rifles it. He continues to have an excellent series with the glove and the bat. Now has seven runs batted in for the series. Cardinal with a weak throw in, and Rose keeps on going to third. Schmidt is going to go because Akins is in a cutoff position between home plate and his right fielder. Schmidt had thoughts of going. Look at that reaction. He's had a big series thus far. Reddy Martin has been throwing in the Kansas City Royals bullpen. Gale has not pitched that badly. He's been... Jim Fry out now. Reddy Martin will come in. Philadelphia Phillies looking for their first World Championship as Martin comes on and Gale leaves.
So we have a break in the action. The Phillies have taken a 2-0 lead here. We'll be right back after these messages. So we're having all kinds of changes here. That is a brand new base at third base. Paul Pryor, the umpire, went in, got the groundskeeper. You see Brett working on it. He's getting used to it. Pete Rose is the base runner. Mike Schmidt's at first. These Philly fans kept wondering when their Phillies would fall behind to win. Well, they've taken the lead. It's only second time in this series that they've done that. Mike Schmidt gave them a two-run homer in Kansas City to give them a lead. Right now, they're leading 2-0. Nobody out. Schmidt is at first. Rose is at third. Bake McBride, a line to left, is the batter. Ball one.
I think an oddity in this series also is the fact that Kansas City's manager, Jim Fry, as we look at the stats of Reddy Martin,
He has only used five pitchers. The Phillies have used 10.
Martin in relief of Gale. And it's low, two balls, no strikes. A.C. Rose at third, Schmidt at first. Mike Schmidt coming on strong, had a tough playoff series, had a tough start. But he's now 8-for-19 with 7 runs batted in. Popped up. Frank White at second base, drifting over. In foul territory, makes the catch. Rose holds. White runs it back. One out. Brings up Greg Luzinski with Gary Maddux on deck.
Get that curveball over and get the double play. He'll turn what is a negative in the sense the Phillies had a big rally going. First and third, no outs, and already scored 2 runs, and he can turn it into a plus for his own ball club if he can get out of this inning with just giving up the 2 runs that Gale has given up.
Ball one. Luzinski was out on strikes his first time up. Rennie Martin in relief of Gale.
Martin, a guy on the mound now who is trained in the minor leagues to be a relief pitcher, and it's awfully tough to come in relief when your best pitch is your curveball, because as you mentioned earlier, Tom, it is more of a field pitch than the fastball.
Hot smash to Brett. He looked to see if he could get Schmidt. Couldn't, so just held on to it. So there are 2 outs, and here is Maddux.
Looking right at the ball. Didn't hit it real hard. In fact, may have broken the bat. It sounded like it shattered, but Brett comes up throwing. He looked the third first. Rose was close, and he couldn't get Schmidt.
Maddux, double in the right center field his first time up. Ball one. Philadelphia just taking a 2-0 lead on a single by Mike Schmidt. A walk, an error, a bunt. Bases were loaded. Schmidt single, driving in 2. There goes Mike Schmidt. Ball is hit deep in the right center field. Cardinal is back, should make the play. He does. So Rennie Martin comes in, puts out the fire, but the Phillies take the lead. At the end of 3, it is Philadelphia 2, Kansas City nothing. Martin walking off after a job well done. 2 up for Kansas City. UL Washington, George Brett, and Al McRae. 2 runs, 4 hits, and no errors for the Phillies. No runs, no hits, 1 error for Kansas City. Scoring 1 earned run, 1 unearned, and the 2 the Phillies scored in the 3rd. Here is UL Washington, who was out on strikes his first time up. It is high, ball 1. Washington came into this game hitting 263 in the series. Out of play, 1 ball, 1 strike.
We talked a little bit earlier about Carlton's strenuous conditioning program. He does not run. When Dallas Green took over last year and set the standard for this spring, he said, you guys are going to do a lot of running. Carlton was exempted because nobody else on this ball club or pitching staff can keep up with his rigorous routine. He works out so hard, 20 minutes every day. Increases strength, flexibility.
Good fastball. And I'll tell you something, when you win 24, lose 9, earn run average is 2.34. You're like the big gorilla. You sleep where you want.
It's one of those fastballs inside part of the plate. It was a cut fastball that went in on Washington. He gets the ball outside part of the plate. It'll run away at times, so he has excellent movement.
In the hole, Boa has it. He's going to try it. He'll not get him. It's a base hit for Washington. That's the first hit for the Kansas City Royals.
I'll tell you what, that little guy at shortstop, and we've raved about how consistent he's been through 11 or 12 years. He did not make this play, but to get to it was something in itself. Look at this. It is much more difficult to stop an artificial surface. On dirt and grass, you can slide that foot and come to a more abrupt stop. You try an artificial surface, your feet go out. He made a nice play just getting to it.
Tony also tied a World Series record by starting his sixth double play this series. Rizzuto in 1951 had six. Brett fouls it off. Boas started the double play in the second inning on a ball hit by John Wathen. Brett bounced out his first time up.
Oh, that isn't a balk where he stepped. I'll tell you. He is bending that rule a long way, Tom. He is getting away with murder. And that one he did anyway.
So if they have those men in blue out there, though.
Boy. Right?
Didn't get it.
I know my buddy Jerry Guzman sitting at home watching lefty throw here, the big lefty up in Minnesota, my teammate for so long in New York. He loves that nice wide left-handed move to first base.
He taught some of these moves to Carlton, as a matter of fact.
Brett, outside.
Steve never gives you the same look when you're a runner at first base. One time the head movement will be a little bit different, the leg kick will be a little bit different, it changes rhythm. Show you eight or nine different things.
Bouncing ball, this could be two, there's one, there's two.
Double play will go down in the record books. Seven double plays, breaking the record held by Rizzuto set in 51. Started his seventh double play. And you know, when you look at scouting reports, this is from our left center field camera. He didn't waste a throw. He took it himself. Why mess up an extra flip?
But also interesting, Tony, when he threw the ball, how he got UL out of there when he submarined it. Ball one on McRae.
Bo has done everything that has been asked of him in this series. Getting on base, making all the plays. He's had an outstanding series to this point.
Ray to Boa. So the Kansas City Royals go down. We go to the bottom half of the fourth inning. The score here, the Philadelphia Phillies 2, Kansas City nothing, as Boa puts on quite a show. And due up for the Philadelphia Phillies, Manny Trio, the man of the hour, Boa, and Bob Boone. Manny Trio will lead it off as we get an overhead shot of Veterans Stadium, a jam-packed Veterans Stadium. These fans, I tell you, this whole town, really, they're waiting. Strike one. As Brian Gumbel said in the pregame show, they have never won a World Series here in Philadelphia. And oh, are they ready. Curveball. It was a beauty. He really had it backing out of there. It missed, but it still broke sharply. One ball, one strike. Jam-packed as we go down towards the left field line. It is a high fly ball. Coming in, Wilson going out, Washington. Who's going to get it? Wilson finally makes it. That was a routine play, and nobody apparently hollered till the last minute, Tony.
Well, when you realize where Willie Wilson came from left field, right now Wilson knows that his infielders are in trouble. Amos Otis was playing a very deep center field. Frank White gave ground to UL Washington to cover second base. There goes Frankie, and then UL, for some reason, gave up on it. He looked toward Otis, and Otis wasn't there. Well, it wasn't. That'll give you an idea of his speed. Where he came from to catch that ball in short center field, tell you how fast he is.
I know it's not the same kind of a play, but the thinking was the same when Billy Martin made the catch it almost sent into the Hall of Fame. It was a pop line to infield in reality, and nobody wanted to catch it. There's a strike.
Larry Ball. Joe, the Kansas City Ball Club is playing the same kind of baseball he played for almost a month and a half. When they got that big lead, they didn't play consistent nine innings for the last month and a half.
Two outs. Brett to Akins gets Boa.
Brett's got to get his bat going, as does McRae, to get this Kansas City Ball Club back in this game.
Carlton going the way he's been going, I got to believe that he's going to get stronger at least through the middle innings, Tom. If, as you say, he may weaken later on, but I got to believe the middle innings, he's in a groove now with the breaking stuff and the fastball.
Here's Bob Boone, who scored one run. He drew a base on balls back in the third inning, and it's ball one. Boone walked. Smith was safe when the throw pulled UL Washington off the bag. Rose beat out a bunt, and Schmidt singled in two runs. Two balls, no strikes. Bob Boone. There's his dad, former major leaguer, Ray Boone. His mom. Two nothing, Phillies lead. Boone makes it high, 3-0. The on-deck batter is Smith, Lonnie Smith. Rennie Martin in relief of Gale.
Bob's father, Ray, there is Smith on deck. Ray was one of the toughest RBI men I've ever seen.
Gave him the green light. High fly ball down the line in right field. Cardinal coming on hard. He makes the catch, so Boone flies out. That ends the fourth inning. At the end of four, the score here is Philadelphia 2, Kansas City nothing. I talked about Billy Martin. We're going to flash back with Mal Allen. You tell me if it was a tough play. It's a fly ball. Here it is again. Jog your memory.
The Yankees are leading by a score of 4-2. Billy Martin, tenths of second. Two out. The Dodgers with the bases loaded. Jackie Robinson hits a high pop-up into the tricky winds of Ebbets Field. Martin makes a game-saving catch, and the Yankees win the series.
Joe Garagiola, Tom Seaver, Tony Kubek, our statistician Steve Dans back here in Veterans Stadium. Game number six of the 1980 World Series. Jim Frey, the manager of Kansas City, he finds his team down by two runs in the top of the fifth. Steve Carlton on the mound will face Otis, Akins, and Wathen. There's Herb's direct, Dallas Green, the manager right behind him. Carlton has allowed just one base hit, infield single by Washington. He has struck out four and walked two through four. Otis has walked. One strike. Otis needs one base hit. He's one short of tying a record for a six-game series. Joe mentioned earlier, Billy Martin, 53 Yankees, had 12 base hits. So Otis has had an excellent series thus far. Phil's two, Kansas City nothing. We're in the fifth. High fastball. Carlton way ahead. Two strikes to the count of Otis.
A good example of what the high fastball out of the strike zone will do to a hitter, especially when you have the kind of pop that Carlton has. Puts him right in the driver's seat. No balls and two strikes. A lot of things a pitcher can do in this situation is set up a pitch, go right after him, especially when you're throwing as well as Carlton is throwing.
I've got to believe in a factor that you mentioned earlier, Tom, that he has pitched over 350 innings since spring training began, that he's not going to try and waste too many. I got to believe he wants to complete this game, Carlton, and go after every hitter and use a minimum number of pitches. He goes outside but just missed. One ball, two strikes. He's got a Kansas City Royals blue baseball cap on, but I got to believe that young man was a Phillies fan. Steve Carlton. Good pitch, but Otis fended it off somehow. Carlton stay at one ball, two strikes. Oh, my goodness.
He's left over from Saturday Night Live. He's one of our fans at NBC.
Well, I know you people all know that Tom Seaver's had an assistant up here, a member of his pitching staff from Cincinnati, Paul Moscow. We thought we'd give you a shot of him before this series was over. One ball, two strikes, and Otis. Breaking ball, bounces, 2-2. Amos Otis, you know, they've talked about Carlton not giving interviews. Another man very reluctant to talk to the media is Amos Otis at the plate. He cherishes his privacy. Two balls, two strikes. The fifth, no outs. Phillies lead 2-0. He blew it by him. Strikeout number five for Carlton. A good, lively fastball.
Game number two that Carlton started, he had 10 strikeouts. Into the fifth inning now, he already has five. And that one on just pure heat. He threw the ball right by Amos Otis.
Well, during the regular season, Carlton pitched 304 innings. He had 286 strikeouts, the most in the major leagues. Nolan Ryan of Houston just got to the 200 mark. Willie Mays Akins, who's had some kind of series, a couple home runs in one game, his first major league triple, a game-winning RBI, then two more home runs. One out. He is beginning to throw a little bit harder. You can almost hear the ball crackling into Boone's glove. One ball, no strike. One out. Breaking pitch, one strike, one and one. Akins with his four home runs in this series, 1977, I know you'll recall that. Reggie Jackson had five, series record. Two and one. Willie Mays Akins. Three balls, one strike.
Another good play by Bob Boone behind the plate, especially off of Carlton. You're going to get a lot of sliders that are going to break down into the dirt. That's his out pitch. Bob Boone, the Golden Glove catcher of the National League.
You can see he is the only catcher in the major leagues who wears that old style mask. Paul Pryor, the umpire for the bases today, the only umpire, popped up. Back of home plate, should go out of play. It does. 3-2.
You also notice that that hat just fits right in that mask. And it's the plastic cap. It's made just for catching. You don't wear it when you're hitting. Booney's got as much protection for his head that he can get. It's just that that little flap is in there, much like you see on the umpire hanging down there. I always wanted that, never got it. I wanted to put steel plates in the toes of my shoes. It wasn't going to hurt my speed. I ran like Luciano. I wanted shoes like him.
Three balls, two strikes, one out. Phillies lead 2-0. Akins, and he got him, he did. He really broke off a hard slider on a 3-2 count. That'll show you the confidence that Carlton has in that slider when he's going right with it, Tom.
Well, we talked about it before, Tony. It's his money pitch. And the second time tonight, he's gotten to 3-2, and he's gone with it. He gets behind, he'll you throw his slider. He's got tremendous control with it. He knows he can get it in the strike zone. Akins, a fastball hitter, probably sitting on the fastball. There's Jim Fry in the Royal dugout. Carlton simply throws the slider for a sixth strikeout.
John Wathan, he grounded into a double play in the second. Carlton now has six strikeouts, as Tom said. One strike. There's a breaking ball that comes around the outside part of the plate, just catches it. One strike to Wathan. Base hit up the middle by Wathan. Second base into the ball game for the Royals. Washington has the other. So Wathan's on, and Jose Cardenal will step in. We've talked a little bit about that conditioning program that Carlton goes through. He has been a weightlifter since he was 14 years of age. He had gotten into the martial arts, karate. Now he's gotten into kung fu. And it's difficult to explain the routine he goes through with Gus Heffling, who also worked for the Philadelphia Eagles. He says he wants to make it a way of life after baseball. Do it every day, all year long. Carlton, first pitch to Cardenal, one ball, no strike.
Not much money for guys like that. Vikings and Shepherds are about in the same class. Kung Fu, how can you make any money?
Steve's not interested in making money, and neither is Gus Heffling. They just know it is an excellent program. In fact, Heffling thinks that he could put it to good use in all of baseball. Two balls, no strikes. On Cardenal, Heffling would like to have a separate program for every man on the field, not the same one for each position. Cardenal with two batting gloves on, Wathan off and running. Wathan will surprise you because he stole 17 bases during the regular season, was caught just three times. So he thought he caught Carlton by surprise and had an excellent jump, but it was fouled off.
You'll get a look at the jump that Wathan gets. Two, three, four, five steps he had before Carlton threw the ball. That was a good jump.
And still see Larry Boa, game number one off Leonard. Down by four, he surprised everybody, may have set up the whole inning. Cardenal pops it up. Short right field, trio back. He will take it himself as he waves McBride off right field. So Wathan is stranded at first base. We're in the middle of the fifth here at Veterans Stadium, Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, with the score. The Phillies 2, the Kansas City Royals nothing. Due up to the Phillies, the leadoff hitter Lonnie Smith, and Pete Rose and Mike Schmidt. Mendelstadt. He gives the safe sign, so the count will go 3-2.
Looks like a breaking ball in the outside corner. Martin has an outstanding curveball, a very good slider to go along with it. 3-2.
Could be a base hit, it is, and this is a bad man to have on if you're a Kansas City fan. Smith's going to keep on going. The throw in from Amos Otis, and Lonnie Smith showed that speed close to Willie Wilson. He took a single and made it into a double, and here the fans are stirred up again.
He sent it right back up the middle. It looked like a pretty good pitch. He didn't hesitate as he got to first base, but stumbled again, but it's an easy two-base hit for him.
Otis was playing Smith, shading him slightly toward right center field, and as soon as Smith hit the ball, he knew he had two. He made that double from home plate to first base.
You think it was an answer of McRae doing that to Maddox the first time and McBride the second, as if to say we can do it too?
Well, you can't underestimate the speed of this Phillies ball club. With Smith on second, Rose will try and pull the ball. Phillies lead 2-0. One ball to Rose. Brennan tied at third base. So is Akins at first. There's your score. Brett, the third baseman. Royals bullpen starts going once again. Too low. Nice stop by Woffitt. Rose. Those two balls and no strikes on Rennie Martin. And Smith, lower left-hand corner of the screen. Pete single to left, check swing in the first, given a single on the bunt down to third base. Paul Splitarf, the left-hander warming up, Marty Patton, the right-hander. The big question is, Splitarf, the third best pitcher on the staff, where has he been? Two balls, one strike on Pete Rose.
Rose's job, of course, in this situation is to pull the ball on the ground to the right side, get Lonnie Smith over to third. Mike Smith will be up.
He hits it to left center field. Amos Otis back, but Lonnie Smith will tag and try for third. Here he comes with that great speed. So Rose didn't pull the ball, but Lonnie Smith's great speed. Otis got the ball in quickly, and he made it to third base. The man coming up right now with 7 RBIs in this series is Mike Schmidt.
Rose's job in that situation to get the runner at third, so Mike Schmidt will be up with that runner on third with one out. There's Pete, the consummate professional. You get it done any way you can, and Pete seems to be able to do it.
A lot of ball clubs up until the sixth inning will pretty much let you hit straight away, making it an option. And knowing Pete Rose, you know he tried to pull that ball, but Rennie did a good job of keeping that ball outside. So Pete said, I'll just try to get the base hit, hit the fly ball, and picked up the base. And that pulls the infield in. That's tough with this fella hitting.
Rennie Martin will pitch from the stretch with Lonnie Smith at third. One ball to Mike Schmidt. Schmidt with a single to right field. There's Lee Elia flashing a series of signs to Schmidt. And believe me, he's not giving him the bunt sign. Schmidt has the 2 RBIs in this ballgame. Phillies lead by 2. Fouled off. He had a good cut and a high breaking pitch. One ball, one strike on Mike Schmidt with one out. He was right on that pitch, Tom.
It's a good example of the power hitter. You can see how he extends his arms. That's a lean in. And the expression on his face saying, oh, how did I miss that one? Awfully powerful man, Mike Schmidt, can hit the ball out of this ballpark any place. Left field, right field, center field.
One out, Lonnie Smith down at third base for the Phillies. Phillies lead over the Royals 2-0. We're in the bottom of the fifth. 1-1 the count on Mike Schmidt. Setting up outside. 2-1, so Martin is behind. Phillies won the first two ball games here at Veterans Stadium. Came from behind, went to Kansas City. Kansas City won the first two, and it looked for a while, as we look at Smith again, that Kansas City was going to sweep the series there. But the Phillies came back. They need just this one victory in game number 6 to become the world's champions. 2-1. Good pitch. Top goes 2-2 to Mike Schmidt.
Martin faced Schmidt the last time in game number 3. First time he faced him, he ran a 2-2 count through a curveball, and Mike grounded out to short. Of course, Mike, in this situation, looking for a ball that can drive to the outfield, get a sacrifice fly.
He's got an edge with that infield in and the artificial surface.
Two balls, two strikes to Schmidt. Nice stop by John Watson. He just saved a run.
Beautiful play. He got that body in front of it. Your job is not to catch it. Your job is to block it. And that curveball from the right-hander, when it hits the ground, will break towards his left shoulder. Watch it reverse. And that's why you have to get right at the edge. And it takes a little bit of guts to do that. And it takes practice because you think the ball is scooting by you. But it breaks back towards you. And he really blocked that ball nicely. Nice play. Boone has been doing it the entire series. And now Watham comes up with a great play.
Three balls, two strikes, one out. Phillies lead 2-0. Schmidt at bat. Way outside, Walker. While we have a chance, we're going to pause briefly for station identification. This is the NBC Television Network. Bake McBride, the cleanup hitter scheduled to hit right now. Joe Garagiola, Tony Kubek, Tom Seaver. There's your score. Phillies 2, Royals nothing. Phillies have runners at first and third with one out. Paul Splittorff, with McBride coming up to bat, will replace Rennie Martin, the third pitcher used by the Kansas City Royals. So there's a break here in Veterans Stadium in Philadelphia. The score, the Phillies 2, the Royals nothing.
We're here at Veterans Stadium for Game 6. Phillies are out in front 2-0, and while Splittorff completes his warm-up pitches, gives us a chance to offer a good wish to our technical director, Horace Ruiz, now working his 15th World Series for NBC. Horace has been a part of NBC for 30 years and one of the many great people who help us do the best job in all of baseball. Tony, Joe.
Horacio, we're going to miss you, pal. First and third for the Phillies. McBride facing Splittorff, his first appearance in this World Series. Fouled out of play by McBride. One strike. There's one out. Splittorff behind Leonard Gura had the most innings pitched on this ball club, and yet he wasn't used until this point. There are your runners. Schmidt at third. Schmidt at first. One strike on McBride. Missed outside. 1-1. I guess you come into World Series, Tom, you've got to have some kind of master plan, if that's the proper terminology, for your pitching through a series. But you go into a series like this and you're afraid to pitch or start your third best pitcher. I'm not so sure that's a wise thing to do, but that's what's happened. He blew it by, but right up tight. One ball, two strikes.
And you know, Tony, Splittorff has pitched extremely well coming down the stretch. At the All-Star break, he was 5-6. Had some back problems during the season, but he ended up 14-11. His innings pitch and hit ratio was not good, but he was a very good pitcher for this ball club down the stretch. More than a little bit miffed about not pitching.
Way outside with a breaking pitch. Two balls, two strikes. One out. Well, the scouting reports that were turned in said to Jimmy Fry that Philadelphia is a right-handed power-hitting ball club. Take a chance with Gura. He's the style pitcher, might beat them, but they didn't think Splittorff could. And I think you put yourself in a hole when you think that before the series even begins. Two balls, two strikes, one out. He broke his bat. They probably will not get two. Smith scores. They do get a runner at first base as Schmidt goes to second. So McBride gets an RBI as Smith, with that great speed, scores. Phillies lead 3-0. He really sawed him off.
I don't think there's any way in the world you're going to get a double play out of Bake McBride unless it's a line drive that somebody catches in the air. A very tough situation to get out of and not give up a run first and third with McBride running, of course. Washington made a fine play at shortstop. Bake McBride gets down that baseline as good as anybody in the National League.
Now it's the Bull, Greg Luzinski, who struck out and lined to Brett at third with Schmidt at second base. Breaking ball too low, 1-0.
That's a run actually the Phillies manufactured on great speed by Lonnie Smith. He stretched the double. He went to third on Pete Rose's fly ball and just scores on the ground ball.
One ball to the Bull with two outs. One ball, one strike. Phillies lead 2-0. We're in the bottom of the fifth. Mike Schmidt at second. He has two runs batted into this ballpark. Chopper The chant of let's go ball, UL Washington throws him out. 6-3 if you're scoring, but the Phillies come up with another run. So the score here, after 5 in Philadelphia, the Phillies 3, the Kansas City Royals nothing. Due up for the Royals, number 9 hitter Frank White, then Willie Wilson, and UL Washington.
Back in Philadelphia, I'm Merle Harmon, Rearley Carpenter, the president of the Phillies. Your family has owned this ball club for, well, a lot of years, since 1945. And now we're down to this final week. What's it been like in Philadelphia this week?
Well, it's been a hectic week, Merle. Of course, we spent a good bit of time in Kansas City early on. We're very pleased, and obviously this is the greatest moment that the Phillies franchise has had since my family owned it.
And this franchise has been going 97 years. Back to the booth.
All right, thank you, Mr. Carpenter. Merle, Frank White pops up to Larry Bowa. Man coming up, Willie Wilson, struck out 11 times in this World Series. It has been written many times about him that he is not carrying his load. He's disappointed it's been said of him.
Yeah, I think it's unfair because we're a team. We're not just one person. Of course, I'm a great part of this team, but I don't feel that I'm the one that's going to make us win or make us lose. I'm the one that's having a part of making us win or lose. And when you have guys like Hal McRae, George Brett, Amos Otis, those guys drive in runs, you can't say I'm not getting on base is going to make us win or lose. It's just unfair pressure put on me.
He is going to be a great ball player. He is already a good defensive player. He just was thrown out by Carlton when he jumped on the first pitch, as Frank White did, bunted back, and Carlton threw him out by about a step. So Carlton has two very quick outs in the top of the sixth. Carlton with a 3-0 lead. Through 5 innings, Carlton had struck out 6, walked 2. Now it's UL Washington. Just 2 base hits off Carlton. UL Washington, infield single. Wathan a single up the middle. Steve Carlton this year will receive his 3rd Cy Young Award. 1 strike for Washington. And I gotta believe Carlton with innings like this, if he gets out with just 4 or 5 pitches, it's going to help him in the 8th and the 9th. One and one to Washington. There are 2 outs. Phillies have won 3 ball games. Royals won the first 2 in Kansas City. One ball, 2 strikes.
Again, our radar gun down there, Tony, has Carlton about 88, sometimes 89 miles an hour. And again, I don't believe it.
That last pitch was a pitch he turned over, though. And that, with that sinker ball action, it might not be quite as hard as when he throws that riding fastball. 1 ball, 2 strikes, 2 outs.
His pitches have good pop on the end. They get to that hitting zone out in front of home plate where those hitters like to make contact. And that fastball is exploding through that hitting zone. That's one of the keys of pitching. Fastballs do 3 things. They go a certain place, they go to a certain speed, and they have certain movement on them. And of the 3 of those things, that movement is probably the most important.
1-2 pitch to Washington, fouled out of play. One ball, 2 strikes, 2 outs. At the top of the 6th, the Phillies leading 3-0. Good, looked like a breaking ball, Tom, to get strikeout number 7. Steve Carlton just getting UL Washington. So in the middle of the 6th, the score, the Phillies 3, Kansas City nothing. It'll be... Maddox trio Bowa to face Paul Splittorff. The 3rd Royals pitcher, Gale, started. Mark came in, and now Splittorff. 1 ball to Gary Maddox for the score here in Philadelphia. 3-0, the Phillies lead over Kansas City. Carlton has allowed just 2 base hits. 2-0, Dallas Green, the man who took over this ball club at the end of last season. And on the last day of the season, he told this Phillies ball club that you go home and look yourselves in the mirror, because you're a much better ball club than you showed this year. And he has been on some of these players all year long. There is Jimmy Fry. Saw his club get off to a big lead early in the Western Division American League. Count goes 3-1 now to Gary Maddux. Line drive, base hit on a 3-1 pitch, so Maddux is on with good speed down at first base, and Tree will be the hitter. See now in the sixth inning if Dallas Green will...
Virtually every time the Kansas City Royals have been behind, Tony, through this series, Paul Moskow keeping the charts over here, there's only about two times when they've been behind in the count that they've thrown something other than the fastball. There you see Brett trying to get the line drive by Maddux, but Maddux ahead in the count 3-1. He simply got a fastball and ripped it to left field.
Dallas Green has some options. He may try and pad that lead, have Trio bunt. Trio, good bat control, hits the opposite way. Brett is creeping in. He's hit and running. Maddux was off and going, and Trio fouled it off. This Phillies ball club has really been under intense pressure throughout the second half of the season. Maddux looking at a sign from Elia. They won 23 of their last 29 on the road. They had to go up to Montreal on the last weekend and win 2 of 3 on the road, and they did. They had 5 tough championship series games against the Houston Astros. They've come from behind in these series ball games. One strike. Split arm throws over. Maddux back easily. Trio the hitter. Phil's lead 3-0. The bottom of the sixth. Ground ball should be 2. Split arm. UL Washington. Over to Akins, and UL that time really made sure he stepped on the bag. They complete the double play, so there are 2 outs, and Bowl will be the hitter.
A good example of the experienced pitcher and the rookie, Rich Gale, the other day, got the ball back to the mound, didn't know where he was going. There's Paul Spidorf, a 34-year-old veteran. He gets the ball, turns right around, and fires a strike to second base. UL Washington, of course, turns it into an easy double play for the Royals.
Boa now will bat from the right side off Spidorf. Chop foul. Boa starting his 7th double play in this ball game. Broke Phil Rizzuto's record. One strike with 2 outs. Way up on the bat, about 6-8 inches. 1-1. Balls, 1 strike to Bowl. Phils with 3 runs on 6 hits, have not committed an error. Kansas City, no runs, 2 hits. They've committed 1 costly error. That by White when he pulled UL Washington off the bag. Good fastball by Spidorf, 2-2. Signed in the back of Spidorf, 1950. National League champs. Those are the Witz kids. Robin Roberts, Richie Ashburn, Eddie. Drilled in the left field corner. Bo's going to have extra bases. Willie Wilson to the wall. Wilson into third base with a throw. So Bo continues to have an excellent World Series with a double off the screen.
Larry Bowes had an outstanding World Series so far. Coming into the day, he was 8-for-20 on a 2-2 count. He got a high breaking ball, and that's a pitch that a good professional hitter won't miss. If you throw it up there in his eyes, he's going to hit it hard somewhere.
Willie Wilson did a good job of getting back there, getting that ball back in there, because he was playing very shallow. And you could see that Bowes made up his mind he was at least going for the double and a possible triple. Wilson plays it well and gets it back in.
So now it'll be Bob Boone stepping in with 2 outs and Bo at second base. Phillies leading 3-0. Bo looking around, checking the outfield. One strike to Boone. Boone walked in the third. That set up that inning where 2 runs were scored. Schmidt got the 2 RBIs. Bo is at second now. Boone is also flying to right. Pull the string. Base hit. Bo will score. It is now 4-0. RBI for Boone.
Another mistake by Paul Splittorff. Bob Boone kept his hands back. It didn't look like that bad a pitch, though. Tony got the ball down, and Booney was out in front, and, of course, Larry Boa scored easily.
I don't think he snapped it off, Tom. He seemed to roll that curveball. It was a flat curveball, and the only danger here is Boa hurting somebody one of those high fives. Watch him. The reaction. He is just banging on everybody.
Jimmy Fry, who is going to have to come from behind with his Royals in this ball game if they are to get their first World Championship. And if they win today, they would still have to win tomorrow. Ruth finished schedule a pitch if we go to game seven. The fans in this ballpark, and they've got a little ways to go yet as we're only in the sixth, are beginning to smell their first World Championship. With Carlton on the mound, and that is your score, Carlton has pitched a very strong ball game, has allowed just two base hits. Steve Carlton looking for his second World Series win in 1980. He won the second ball game. He has a 4-0 lead. Now it's Boone at first. Smith, he's been on base twice. He's the hitter. One ball, Alani Smith. Outside, two balls, no strikes, with two outs. Dallas Green, who came out of the front office, is not certain whether he will come back next year. Fouled out of play by Smith on a 2-0 pitch. 2-1 now. Dallas Green has made the comment. He's had run-ins with a lot of his ball players. He said, I don't care if they don't like me. Some of these guys have got to learn how to play and win. Outside, three balls, one strike. Green has not yet committed himself as to whether or not he will return next year. He said if a few trades are made, I might come back. Gotta believe that Rudy Carpenter and the bunch will want him back. Three balls, two strikes on Lonnie Smith with two outs. Bob Boone's at first. The Phillies lead 4-0.
He managed by that old school theory of I don't have to like them. They have to get to know me.
Well, he had his leader on the field, and Pete Rose. Seaver talked to him before the ball game. Fly ball, center field. Amos Otis over to right center. He's got it. So the Phillies will strand a base runner, but Boone with a big RBI single pads the Philadelphia lead after six, 4-0. But the Royals in the seventh will send up George Brett, then Hal McCray, and Amos Otis. We'll be back after these messages from your local station.
Joe Garagiola with Tony Kubek and Tom Seavers. We go to the seventh inning. 4-0, the Phillies are leading. Four runs, eight hits, no errors. Royals, no runs, two hits, and one error. This telecast is presented by authority of Major League Baseball and is intended solely for the private, non-commercial use of our audience. In any publication, reproduction, retransmission, or other use of the pictures, descriptions, and accounts of this game without the express written consent of Major League Baseball is prohibited. Jim Fry says it all as he sits there. Gross is the new left fielder, replacing Lonnie Smith for the Philadelphia Phillies. They lead by four. George Brett, Hal McRae, and Amos Otis. Somebody's got to get something started for these Kansas City Royals because time is running out. And Carlton, seven strikeouts. He has walked two. He has allowed two hits. Bounces all the way back. And Carlton in 1980 lasted past the sixth inning in 40 of his 41 starts, and this includes postseason play. There's a strike, and the way Carlton has been going, George Brett may be batting for the last time in this game. Carlton is going in to nail it down. Line foul. One ball, two strikes. 65,838. It's the largest crowd in vet history. It's the largest World Series crowd since October 11th of 1964. A base hit in the right field, and Brett is on.
I think that hit right there will give you an idea of the kind of hitter Brett is. He had to be protecting the outside part of the plate, looking for a breaking ball, and yet Carlton threw, I think, the pitch he wanted to, Tom, high and tight, and yet he still could get around and drill it through the infield.
He did make a good pitch. Against Carlton, you have to protect the outside corner. You have to protect against that slider, but Brett is quick enough to turn on that ball and hit it in the hole.
Here is Hal McRae. McRae came into this game hitting at 450. Off the handle, a high fly ball, short left field. Ball going out, taking charge, makes the play. One out. Brett and Wendelstedt visiting as Amos Otis comes to the plate. Otis walked in the second. He struck out in the fifth. There you see the defense with Otis, the batter, and Brett on at first base. We are in the seventh. It's 4-0 Philadelphia leading. Game six, Phillies lead in games 3-2. Strike one. Good fastball. He's just rearing back and firing now. Strike two, good fastball.
Carlton's thrown two of his best pitches right out there on the outside corner. You see Brett at first. And now what do you do if you're the hitter? 0-2, he's got a nasty slider. Is he gonna go out there or come inside?
High fly ball, deep to right field, way back. McBride near the wall, makes the catch. A two-strike, no ball count. Notice, made a bid for a home run, but not enough.
Carlton has thrown about 90 pitches so far in the game, and this might be the worst pitch that he's thrown so far. It's the same kind of pitch that Otis hit off of Ruthven the other day in Kansas City for a home run, a fastball up and out over the plate. McBride made a good play going just short of the wall to call it in, but where you have to throw, Otis, is the hard stuff in on the inside part of the plate.
What in the world was our cameraman for that? That was some shot. You saw that ball go right in the glove. Tom, you think the four-run lead is what made him throw that ball down the middle?
I think it was a mistake, Joe. Made two beautiful pitches and tried to go away. I think he probably wanted to go in.
Aikens, a curveball, is a strike. It's one of the dangers you have when you get a little bit of a lead. Pitchers start throwing that ball down the middle. They don't want to walk anyone. Curveball hangs high, and it's one ball and one strike. Two outs.
Carlton has really got a good pace going now. First time he pitched earlier in this ball game, they were stepping out on him. Now the hitters are jumping in, and he's got what he wants. No pitch.
Time. Three umpires called time. Something happened.
The third base foul line umpire out to pick something up that was thrown on the field. Don Dinkinger. There is the bullpen. Rod Reed, the right-hander, and Tug McGraw up once again for the Phillies.
Misses. Two balls, one strike. There are two outs. Brett is on at first. Aikens walked and called out on strikes. Misses. Three balls and one strike. Carlton has walked two. They were back to back in the second inning.
The first time Aikens faced Carlton, game number three, faced him four times and one for four. Walked him one for three, walked him one time. In those four trips to the plate, Aikens saw only four fastballs, a full ration of curveballs and sliders.
Strike. 3-2, a full count. This crowd is starting to rev it up.
Al, over the last 2 years, Willie Mays Aikens has hit about 155 total off left-handed pitching.
Time is called again. Willie Aikens, no controversy where he's standing tonight for some reason. He's just getting in there and ready to hit, and here we go. Brett was running, of course, and Aikens fouls it off. 4-0, we're in the seventh inning.
trio, the second baseman, is playing Willie Mays Akins in short right field. Akins, of course, does not run well. Look at where Trio is. Doesn't run well, but that is also how much confidence Trio has in that great throwing arm he's got.
Carlton had to throw to first base. Rose playing behind Brett. Had to avoid the balk. Tapped. Carlton will have to make the play. He does. So the Royals go down in the seventh inning. We go to the bottom half of the seventh inning, and the crowd is starting to work themselves up. Bottom of the seventh, it is Philadelphia 4, Kansas City nothing. And due up for the Phillies, it'll be Pete Rose, Mike Schmidt, and Mick McBride. This could be a World Series record. Most horses before a game ends. That's the Mounted Police who are here for the after the game, should the Phillies wrap it up. We had the privilege of having lunch with the mayor of Philadelphia today in a great little Italian restaurant in South Philadelphia. And he said that they're just going to have all kinds of precautions and hopes that if they do clinch it, it'll be a show of happiness and exuberance rather than violence and vandalism. It's been a long time. The Philadelphia Phillies have never won a World Series. Pretty apparent the Philadelphia Athletics won many with the great players they had, but these Phillies fans are ready, and the mayor and the people, the disc jockeys, the television people have really done a great job today telling the fans, hey, have fun, but let's not have any vandalism. Let's enjoy this. It's a great moment, but they still have to clinch it. We're in the bottom of the seventh. They're leading by four. And it's ball one. Two balls, no strikes. Foul back. Mike Schmidt is the on-deck batter, and I'll tell you, the most valuable player is going to be tough to choose. Boone is 7 for 17, a .412 average. Schmidt, who you see there, 8 for 20, a .400 average, 7 RBI, 6 runs, 2 home runs. Boa, .391. He set a double play record. I tell you, it's going to be tough. Foul back. Two balls, two strikes. You better start thinking about it, guys. We got to vote.
Well, I haven't quite counted Kansas City out yet.
I haven't either.
I know you hadn't either. So I'm not even thinking voting for any. We just got one up here, but not yet.
George Brett knocks it down. Can't make the play. Face him.
We've talked about Brett throughout this series as not being a one-dimensional ball player and how aggressive he is, not only with the bat, but with a glove. He almost robs Pete Rose of a base hit to left field. He is very quick. Brett weighs about 200 pounds, but you can see his agility right there. That ball was hit really hard, and yet he still got a glove on it after two quick steps in the dive. Split arm is going to leave, Joe.
There you see George Brett with Frank White. 4 runs, 9 hits, no errors for Philadelphia. No runs, 3 hits, and 1 error for the Kansas City Royals as Fry makes a pitching change. So we've got a break in the action, and there is Kenny Brett, George's brother. Marty Patton is coming in the ballgame. We'll be right back after these messages. Marty Patton continues to loosen up. Well, I got a chance here. We wished well to Horace Ruiz, who his last World Series is going to be retiring. I think he exemplifies our entire technical crew have done such a tremendous job working the wee hours of the morning, getting those cables set, getting us great pictures. And I saw a line, it belongs to Ernest Hemingway. It was applied to Tug McGraw. I think it belongs also, as far as Horace Ruiz and our technical crew, grace under pressure. Great job, guys, all of you. And here we go, Mike Schmidt. He had a tough playoff series, he said, but you'll hear from me. He started off slowly here, but they've heard from him. It's a strike. Donna Schmidt looking on.
Patton's first appearance in this series. He was 4-0 during the regular season with four saves.
One ball, one strike, on at first base. Pete Rose, nobody out. Seventh inning. Fastball is inside. Two balls and one strike.
Patton's nickname is Bulldog. One of the nicknames, of course, that you can acquire around a clubhouse, as you well know, Tony. Bulldog, he's a real battler. The senior member of the Kansas City staff, 37 years old, 5'10", 180. And he is a real competitor.
He's got a pretty good slider at times.
Right, there goes Rose. Swung on, missed. Here's the throw. It is in time. Nice play by Frank White. Low throw, scooped it up, put the tag on Rose, and he's out trying to steal.
It's kind of throw that an infielder taking a tag at second base doesn't mind. You'd like to have it down there, especially on this throw from Watting in a short hop.
I can still remember Tony Gil Hodges, who was my great manager with the New York Mets, talking about sliding straight into the base. And you can see as Pete tries to get off to the side, the quickest way to the base is a straight line. Maybe he figures he knows he's out.
Curveball misses, three balls and two strikes. There you see, Pete. I don't know if he was talking to a player or to us. Struck him out. Mike Schmidt caught looking. Strikeout. So there are two away. Brings up Mike McBride.
Patton's got a pretty good breaking ball, a slider, and Mike evidently looked like he was fooled on the pitch because it's right there. A fine pitch by Marty Patton.
Two men out, nobody on. 4-0. Philadelphia leading, bottom of the seventh. Ball one. McBride lined out, fouled at the first baseman, bounced out, drove in a run in the fifth. High chopper, Akins to Patton, gets by him. Bake McBride trying to avoid the collision, falls down. Bake McBride.
Patton almost didn't get over in time, and then he tried to cut across the bag. Akins let him a little bit too much time, made him extend himself, but this will give you an idea of Bake McBride's speed. Akins a little bit too far out in front to Patton.
Good shot of Wathen backing up the play. It'll be an error on Akins.
Patton did get over there in good time, Tony. He made a good run to the line and goes up the line. It's the bad throw that from Akins that pulls him into McBride's path. If he'd had a good throw, it had been able to touch the bag and come right back into fair territory. But the bad throw pulled him in front of McBride.
So McBride is on. Batter is Luzinski. It's low, ball one. Two men out. The official scorers are Phil Collier at the San Diego Union. He's the president of the Baseball Writers Association. Don Fahnensteel, Independence, Missouri Examiner. Luzinski doesn't get it. And Bob Kennedy at the Camden Courier Post. Those are the official scorers, and they ruled Akins was the culprit. One ball, one strike. Did he go around? Yes, he did. And it's strike two.
Some of the errors in this series by Kansas City and mental mistakes as we look at this breaking pitch from Patton. And stopped by Wathen. But I think some of the mental mistakes and errors have really put this Kansas City Royals pitching staff in trouble throughout this series, Tom. They've made them make those extra pitches, giving the extra out to the Phillies.
Strikeout. Luzinski is out on strike, so that ends the inning. And there is Gene Luzinski looking on, and much like Donna Schmidt, frustrated. That ends the seventh inning. The score at the end of seven complete innings, it's Philadelphia 4 and Kansas City nothing. And due up for the Kansas City Royals in the eighth inning, trailing by 4. It'll be John Wathan, Jose Cardenal, and Frank White. John Wathan, Jose Cardenal, and Frank White. We are in the eighth inning. Philadelphia 4, Kansas City nothing. Carlton has struck out 7. He has walked 2. He has allowed 3 hits. Three hits, single by Washington in the fourth. Double play rubbed that out. After 2 strikeouts, he gave up a hit to Wathan. Ball 1, that was in the fifth inning. And then Brett led off the seventh with a single. Carlton retired 3 men in a row. It's a strike. Carlton, to me now, is using the Sal Rugovan theory, throwing strikes where the high ball hitters hit over it, and the low ball hitters hit under it. He's throwing it right down the middle with something on it. He's got a... It's outside. Rugovan was the pitcher with Detroit and the White Sox, and I love this theory. Throw it down the middle, low ball hitters hit under it, high ball hitters hit over it.
That's a bad theory in the sixth game of the World Series. You get in the pattern.
That would start
and
stuff.
And start just throwing the ball down the middle, and all of a sudden you get in the groove, and you get tattooed, and then can't get back in your rhythm.
And you start getting cute out there, nipping corners and walk somebody, and you're going to get nailed right to the outfield fence. 2 balls and 1 strike. The one thing he wants to stay away from are bases on balls. 3-1 to count.
That's Carlton's 100th pitch, Joe.
There's a strike.
Take it all the way. Wathan went up, looked at Gordon McKenzie. He gave him the sign. Take at least 1 strike. 3-1. He gave him the take sign again. You got to get somebody on. You can't go wailing away and hope to get a base hit. Not the way this man's throwing.
Out of play. Count remains full at 3-2.
He's just gone over 100 pitches, and to put it into perspective, here in the eighth inning, he's got 102 now. In game 3, when he pitched against the Royals, he pitched 8 innings, won the ball game, but in those 8 innings, he threw 159 pitches. He's much, much sharper tonight.
Fouled out of play once again. He's coming right down the middle with it.
I'll tell you, I think it was a tremendous idea you had, Tom, to get Paul Moskow to keep an in-depth chart for us and use the radar gun, and we can see patterns that have developed through this series that you've pointed out, Carlton to Akins, and what Carlton and other pitchers have thrown.
He walked him, a base on balls. That's the third walk given up. First base runner here in the eighth. Cardenal, the batter, nobody out. And now Boone wants to go out and talk to him. Keep in mind that it was McCarver who was always Carlton's catcher. He was his private catcher. In fact, Timmy used to make jokes saying, when we die, I'm going to be buried. As we look at McGraw in a bullpen, we're going to be buried 60 feet, 6 inches apart. He just caught every game, but Booney's come on, and he's done some job. 24-9, I got to believe it's quite a job. Cardenal, he is looking for his first base hit. Taking all the way, it's a strike. Cardenal, who came in that tough spot in Kansas City as a pinch hitter, and McGraw was able to strike him out to end the game. Line drive, pull foul on the left field line. 2 strikes. Wathan heads back to first.
Cardenal 0 for 2 tonight, was 0 for 4 in game 3 against Carlton, with 2 strikes out and also grounded into a double play. So Steve has given him nothing but fits in the 2 games that Jose has faced him.
1 ball, 2 strikes. Boone was ready to throw. Wathan is on at first. Trailing by 4, you wouldn't think he'd be gone, but both clubs have run whenever. Curveball misses. 2-2. Line drive, base hit. Cardenal has his first base hit. Wathan stops at second. Nobody out, and Frank White is the batter.
Tom, looked like a breaking ball, a slider that Carlton got up. Dallas Green, Bobby Wine. Is he going to make a move? He has McGraw ready.
I would believe that that was kind of a sign he had with the bullpen when he went to his left arm as he came up to the top step of the dugout. McGraw is ready, and his crowd will really react when he comes on because he has really been something. He is going to make a move, and Carlton should get a nice hand as he walks off. The crowd's starting to react already.
McGraw's had quite a day.
The crowd reacted to Carlton, who had such a tremendous year to put him here, and now McGraw.
Well, McGraw this afternoon started off by having a tugboat renamed after him. He christened it. There's your star, but McGraw, his fourth ball game, one win, one loss. Outstanding ERA this World Series, 1.59. I think amazingly, in 5 2/3 innings pitch time, he's done what he did the last part of the season. Ended up in Montreal when he struck out 5 of 6 in a weekend game. He struck out 8, 5 2/3 innings.
You go across and look at his numbers, Tony, you say, well, 5 2/3, he's got 6 walks, his control has been bad. Well, Tug is a guy that'll look at an inning and find his out men. He has outstanding control of all the pitches that he can throw. A tremendous competitor, and I firmly believe in my mind, in game 5 back in Kansas City, there was no way that he was going to let Amos Otis beat him in that ball game. He wanted to pitch to Jose Cardenal for the third out of the inning.
Tug McGraw, the man of the hour in this crowd, some 65,838 reacted to him coming in. Joe Garagiola here with Tony Kupak and Tom Seaver. This is game 6. The Phillies leading in games 3-2, leading this game 4-0. McGraw's replaced Carlton. We have Wathan on at second base. Cardenal is the base runner at first. And due up for the Phillies, it'll be... due up for Kansas City will be Frank White, Willie Wilson, and UL Washington. They've got to get it going. They've got to start here. Jim Fry. Base runners at first and second.
Joe, we've talked off and on during this World Series about scouting reports, and I think one of the most important places they come into play is setting up your defense. They've done an outstanding job, as we look at Brett, setting the Phillies defense, and there have been so many balls hit hard in the infield in the middle of the diamond that Bo and Trio have converted into double plays. The pitchers have really executed well, putting the ball where they are supposed to.
Here we go. White, Wilson, Washington do up. Base runners at first and second. Nobody out. Takes it low, ball one.
Continue to take a strike. First two hitters did off Carlton. There's your defensive alignment for White, Boa, and Trio playing him up the middle of the diamond. Looking for the double play. Maddox shade toward right field.
It's popped up in foul territory. Rose. One out. Brings up Willie Wilson as Rose hauls in the pop fly hit by Frank White. Wilson struck out in the first. He struck out in the third. Tried to beat out a bunt, but Carlton got him in the sixth.
They have just powered the ball by Willie Wilson. We pointed out he has struck out 11 times. He is just a kid, he admitted before the game the pressure is really on him. He's tried too hard. He's been strangling that bat, and it just been blowing the ball by him.
Ball one.
He's the kid who got 230 hits during the regular season. The second, there's Watson at second. Cardinale for the second man in baseball history to get 100 hits from each side. Gary Templeton last year, this year Wilson.
Screwball is high. Two balls and no strikes. The on-deck man is UL Washington, followed by George Brett. 4-0. Phillies are leading. We are in the eighth. Strike. Two balls, one strike. Cordy McKenzie. Coaching at third. Not much going on here. 2-1 count. 3-1. Now he'll take a look down at the sign. Graw pitching himself into trouble. If Wilson gets on, the tying run will be at the plate in the person of UL Washington, followed by George Brett. Watham at second. Cardinale at first. Walked him, bases loaded, tying runs at the plate.
The obvious controversy in this inning, of course, is Dallas Green taking Steve Carlton out while pitching a shutout, just giving up four hits to the Royals through seven innings and getting into the eighth with the first two men getting on. But a well-rested Tug McGraw in the bullpen and the job that he's done so far and the job that he's done down the last half of the season for the Phillies. That's the fact that Steve Carlton had pitched 350 innings, counting everything from the start of spring training.
UL Washington, single in the fourth, struck out in the first, struck out in the sixth. Strike one. The on-deck batter as we look at the base runners. Watham at third, Cardinale at second. Willie Wilson is at first.
Tom, I guess you've got to go with what got you here. Fry's done the same thing with Quisenberry. McGraw's had the kind of year you just talked about, the finishing part of the season. McGraw's done the job more than Quisenberry has so far in this World Series.
Low screwball, one ball and one strike. There's the on-deck man, George Brett. 4-0. The tying run is in the batter's box.
The Royals have got it going, but several times during this series, they have not been able to come up with that key hit. There they are. The bases are loaded.
One out. Foul back. One ball, two strikes.
That's what Jimmy Fry was saying before this ball game, trying to sum up what's happened to his ball club. He said, we haven't gotten the big hit, and we haven't made the big pitch. When you can't do that, you've got a bad problem. There's Fry.
Billy Bullpen continues to throw. Time now, too much. McGraw trying to make that bat just a little heavier in UL Washington's hands. He builds it up and it got a bit heavy back out. Bases loaded. Left center field, Maddox taking charge, tagging up Watson. He's going to try to score. He will. It's 4-1 as the throw goes in the third. Sacrifice fly. So McGraw gets his second out, and it brings up George Brett. 4-1, base runners, Cardinals at second, Wilson is at first.
This will be an interesting confrontation because in game five, in the seventh and the ninth inning, McGraw struck Brett out both times with fastballs high and away. Brett in this situation looks inside for one pitch or so, a ball he can pull. I doubt if he's going to have to take side. The other guys have.
He's the time run in the batter's box. He'll be swinging from the time he, thinking it, from the time he left the bench.
Strike one.
He's the one man they wanted up there in the spot. Here's the spot and here's the man.
He hit the dramatic home run against Rich Gossage in that championship series deep in the upper deck, which won it for them.
One ball, one strike. Right now at second base, Wilson at first. On deck, Hal McRae. Foul ball. One ball, two strikes, two outs.
Well, let's see if McGraw now continues the pattern, which he struck Brett out in game number five twice, and go to the fastball. You got to believe that Brett's going to be looking that way.
Trio gets it. Rose covering. Safe. Safe. He was off the bag. Bases are loaded.
McGraw went with a screwball, I believe, or a slow curve. Couldn't tell exactly what the action of the ball was. Trio makes an excellent play. McGraw, well, he was coming over in time. Then Pete cut in front of him, and he just missed the bag.
If Pete had gotten out of the way of this ball, Tony, Tug McGraw, who we talked about the other day being an outstanding athlete, was right in position and would have beaten Brett to the bag. After that fastball gets out of the way, after the here's the pitch to Brett, the breaking ball that he hits. After Pete goes after the ball and gets away from the bag, it's the pitcher's job to get over there. And I believe Tug had made that play had Pete not been in the way.
He had the throw in front of him. Rose had his back to Trio.
Here is Hal McRae now. Two men out. It's high, ball one. Remember, Willie Akins on a ball came back to Gura, missed the bag, and Schmidt had a home run. Royals fans are saying, can lightning strike? McRae. Base is loaded. High. Two balls, no strikes.
McRae has just one RBI in this World Series, but he hasn't had a whole lot of opportunities. He's let off a lot of innings. He has not left that many men on. He's got singles to keep rallies going.
High ball three. 3-0. McGraw. Three balls, no strikes to McRae. And he took a good look at Gordy McKenzie. The bases are loaded. There are two outs. Phillies are leading 4-1. Taking. It's a strike. And the base runner. Down the right field line near the stands. Rose giving it a chase. Out of play. Three balls, two strikes, two outs. Eighth inning, Philadelphia 4, Kansas City 1.
Three players with outstanding efforts. Rose will climb the tarp. McBride coming from right field and Trio coming from his second base spot. What intensity.
George Brett, if you're scoring, was credited with a hit. Swing.
fastball. Looked like he threw him a breaking pitch. 3-2.
McRae, who had 39 doubles during the season, Yount led with 49. If he should happen to hit one now with the runners breaking, so we'll score them all. Brett was around second base by the time the ball got to the plate. 3-2, two outs, they're off and running. Out of play.
I think if you talk to the Royals players who they'd like to have up in this situation, they name one or two men. Brett might be one, but that guy right there would rank very close to George Brett. He's been a tremendous clutch hitter for that ball club. Not only the Royals, Tony, Dallas Green was quoted as saying he was the one man he didn't want to see up there in a game situation, McRae. And he's up there now. Bouncing ball, trio, big hop, has it. Inning's over. Does it again. We go to the bottom of the eighth. The score here, Phillies 4, Royals 1. For the Phillies, it'll be Gary Maddux, Manny Trio, and Larry Boa.
On a 3-2 count, Tug McGraw with Hal McRae at the plate. This may well be the biggest pitch of the series. Bases loaded and the runners are going. A fastball, it looks like, in the outside part of the plate. Hal McRae looked like he was looking for something inside. A ground ball at Manny Trio and over to first, and the Phillies get out of the inning with just giving up one run. The Phillies lead 4-1 with three outs to go to be world champions.
And there he goes again. McGraw, very emotional, hyper, pounding his heart. Here is Gary Maddux, and he's in the race for the most valuable player as we look at Quisenberry, who's come on for the Kansas City Royals. Ball one, pitching off the stretch as he has throughout most of this series, even with nobody on. Time is called. A firecracker just went off in center field. And the crowd really reacting the way they should.
You can see the stats of Dan Quisenberry. One win, two losses, high ERA. And he has struggled. He has been the salvation of this Royals ball club throughout most of the season. He has done his job every time.
Two balls, no strikes.
He has gotten ground balls in the series. Some have bounced over, some through. They've hit him kind of hard. Schmidt has hit him hard several times. McGraw's done the job, and Quisenberry hasn't often enough for Kansas City.
Down on left field line, Willie Wilson near the stands may have a play. He does. Willie Wilson makes the catch. So Maddux is out. There is one out. Quisenberry has appeared in all six games as we look at Wilson. It's a new World Series record for six games. Wilson finds the fence, as you see. Moves up, makes the catch. The old record in six games is four appearances by Larry Sherry in 1959 and Jerry Staley for the White Sox in 59. But Quisenberry sets a new record should the series end in six. Got the big base hit in Kansas City off Quisenberry. Line went right back at him to drive in Del Unser, who had driven in Schmidt to tie the game with a pinch hit double. Bouncing ball, UL Washington, big hop. Two outs. Looking ahead to the ninth, Amos Otis, Willie Akins, and John Wathan as we look at the Kansas City bench.
Heard some boos from these people this year, but not in this World Series the way he's played, with the bat and with a glove. Like he on a radio show he has blasted Dallas Green late in the season.
Fly ball right field. Cardinal is there. Three up, three down. We complete eight innings, and now we go to the ninth. And the score, Philadelphia 4, Kansas City 1. Fans are on their feet. The Phillies have never won a World Series. Keep that in mind. And it'll be up to Tug McGraw to nail it down
and two up for Kansas City. It'll be Amos Otis, a hot hitter, Willie Akins, a power hitter, and John Watson. Tomorrow night, NBC Nightly News examines the blue-collar vote. And Friday on NBC Magazine with David Brinkley, Betsy Aaron looks at kids' sports. Are they too strenuous for 6-, 7-, 8-year-olds? And then next month, Roger Mudd joins NBC News. This is the ninth. The crowd's on its feet. And Amos Otis is checking his vision. The crowd will pretty much tell you what's happening in this ninth inning.
$270 each. 42 shares. That is not official.
Strike. Two balls, one strike. Disagreeing with the plate umpire Nick Bremigan as McGraw just waits. Two balls, two strikes.
Set up beautifully. He really did. Tug, of course, has four or five pitches that he can use at any one time, and he's a master using them when he's on.
Willie Akins, the batter. One out. Phillies 4, Kansas City 1, top of the ninth. Nobody on.
Kansas City knows that McGraw got himself in trouble in game number 5 over in Kansas City. Base on balls, got himself in trouble, and this is they're looking for a place to get their foot in the door, and this is what they want.
Remains at 2-2.
2-2. One out. Willie Akins draws the base on balls, and the crowd goes down, up with the strikes. They have never won a World Series, the Philadelphia Phillies. We're going to have a pinch runner here. As you see Concepcion come out of the dugout. This town has been waiting for it a long time. We saw it all day today, all day yesterday.
McGraw, as he did in inning number 8, might be back in a little bit of trouble. Walked 2 in the 8th. Now he walks Akins.
Time is called down the right field line as we look at Akins. It's been a tremendous championship series, a tremendous series, and should this end tonight, there really are no winners and no losers. They both are winners and losers. Both teams played well. A tremendous series. Runner at first, strike one. How these Phillies battled all year. Kansas City, great year. Base hit, right field. Concepcion stops at second. One out, tying run is at the plate again in Cardenal as Wathan gets his second hit of the night. Sends the buzz through the stands. Cardenal singled his last time up.
Phillies bullpen starts going once again as we look at the Royals bench.
They've been referring to these Phillies, as we see an overhead shot, as the cardiac kids. And once again, the tying run is at the plate, which has been typical of this whole series. They have gone, both clubs, to the 27th out. Foul back. 27th out with the chance to win.
Play in this kind of situation, but Booney, with a great confidence in his arm, Rose sneaking back, a play that was pre-planned. Rose caught the foot of John Wathan, almost shielded him off the bag, never did tag him though.
Pete Rose can't get in the front door, try the back door, he'll try anything. 2-2 pitch, foul back.
center field. It is a base hit. They're going to hold everybody up. The bases are loaded. And Frank White is the batter. The tying runs are on. There you see Martinez, the coach at first base, as he pats Cardinal at second base. Wathan, Concepcion stopped at third. And Frank White is the batter.
I think it's just marvelous as we look at Dallas Green, the way this Kansas City ball club, who looked like they were completely beaten by Carlton early in this ballgame when he was almost overpowering them, have come back in both the eighth and the ninth inning and threatened this Phillies ball club.
Frank White, who is 2-for-24 in the batter's box. It's popped up. Boone, Rose, they'll have a play. Boone dropped it and Rose caught it. Rose was right there. It popped out of his glove and Rose made the play.
Give me an idea as we look at Boone approaching the dugout. He picks it up. How much Pete Rose hustled. He came over to help out if he needed the help. It scoots away. And Rose keeps it from going in the dugout. So they get it out. The hustle of Pete Rose.
Pete Rose, a tremendous play. He's like the garbage collector that they refer to in the hockey games. He's always around the puck. He was around the ball. It popped out of Boone's glove. What a play he made. Strike. Willie Wilson. You see the canine corps in the backdrop.
Part of the security here, the stadium. We've talked about it before.
Kansas City bullpen making their way in. Fouled off. UL Washington, the on-deck hitter. It is two strikes on Willie Wilson. Base is loaded. Two outs. What pressure on McGraw? What pressure on Wilson? Tell you what happens. Philadelphia Phillies are the world champions. It's happening here in the stands. Mike Schmidt is the most valuable player, and now in the clubhouse of the world champion Philadelphia Phillies,
we have Brian Gumbel. Brian?
Okay, Joe, I don't know what it's like outside, but it's bedlam inside. Larry Boa, 9 hits in the series, a hit in at least every game, record-setting number of double plays. This has got to feel wonderful.
Oh, man, I can't tell you how good I feel right now, Brian. Everybody said we couldn't win. They said, no, the Phillies aren't good enough. They don't have heart. They don't have character. We have all of the above, believe me. We want to win more than anybody. Tug scared us. Kansas City's got a great baseball team.
Let me get to this man behind you, Dallas Green.
I see you, Peter.
Pete Rose, now you've been through this before. Don't you ever get tired of it?
No, you don't ever get tired of this, Brian. We've been through a lot of adversity this year. We won the big ones. We've been coming back for the last 8 weeks, and we beat a good team in Montreal, and then we beat a good team in Houston, and we beat a good team in Kansas City.
I've got to think that foul ball that you caught at the end typify the Phillies season, hanging on the edge, getting things when it seemed like you wouldn't.
Well, things were bouncing our way the last couple months, and that was a perfect example of it. You know, I knew Booney had it all the way, and he was calling it, just come out of there, and I just, nothing else to do, but I just go over there and try to back him up a little bit.
Did a wonderful job. Team effort. Let me see if I can get to Dallas. Dallas, it has been a season of confrontation, a season of some displays that you would sooner forget, I'm sure, a season of tension for you. The moment is worth it.
Yeah, it is, Brian. We're world champions. There's a lot of people in baseball didn't think we could be. I knew in my heart we could be. I think in September, from then on, our ball players knew we could be. Paul Owens knew we could be, and he's the guy that directed this thing all the way. I'm proud of everybody on our baseball team.
Why did this Philly team win it when others did not? Why this one?
They had heart, and I use the term character. Character is a hard thing to explain unless you've been through what we've been through in September in the playoffs and in the World Series, Brian. This team is just an unbelievable baseball team right now. We could beat anybody in the world.
Paul Owens, you have been through the bad times with this team. You have been here when people called it a country club atmosphere that could not win. The man on your right, how much of the credit does he take? I know he wants to give it to his players. How much do you want to give to him?
I want to give a lot to him because the man went down and did the job that he knew that he and I knew that we had to do. And the players responded. And it may took 4 or 5 months to get it across, but he did it. And I'm so damn proud because it probably is the best move I ever made in my whole baseball career.
This may seem like an inappropriate time to ask it. Is he your manager next year?
You're damn right. If he wants it, he's got it.
Dallas, you said the way to get rid of you was to win it all. Do you want to be back here?
I do what Pope tells me to do. We'll see. Too early to tell.
And that's with love and respect. That isn't without it, because he's got his own mind, and that's why he's down here. And that's why a guy like...
Let me get to 45 for a minute. Tucker, come here for a minute. Did you milk the moment for us? Was that just for our benefit?
I was running out of gas, Brian.
Playoffs ended, it was said, hey, you pitched in every game, that if somebody touched your left arm, it would fall off. But instead, you pitched in the series, you won one game, you saved two. A lot of time to rest now.
Well, Brian, I just ran out of gas today. I kept getting in trouble. I was missing with pitches, but I just heard everybody yelling and hollering. And all the guys were out there screaming and hollering. I saw them police dogs running on the field. I said, reach back and find some extra. That's what this whole team's been reaching back and finding some extra, it seems like, since Moby Dick was a guppy. But, Brian, it just was there when we needed it. I'd like to say hello to my mom and my little brother out in California, my Uncle Henry out there, too, and Aunt Edith.
Tucker, thank you. Let me grab Bob Boone in here. Booney, you came into the game hitting 400. You picked up another hit in this one. You caught solid baseball throughout, despite some nagging pains. Steve had a lot of stuff early on, didn't he?
Steve threw very well, Brian. I thought he got a little tired there at the end, and I had alerted the bench to it earlier, and when he struggled at all, you know, Tug's been doing such a great job. I went to Tug right away, and the Royals being very selective naturally in that situation, he was just a little fine and just missing. But once again, he came through, and this club has just done it all year. Fantastic.
Booney, congratulations. Thank you much. Let me bring Gary Maddox in here. Gary, you are one of the people. Congratulations.
Thanks,
you
Brian.
Were one of those who had your problems with Dallas Green as this year went along. Willing to forgive and forget?
All the way. You know, it's world championship time now, so we're happy about that.
Are you willing to admit now that what he did, he had to do?
Well, in his mind, I'm sure he felt he did what he had to do. You know, sometimes it just... you got to make an adjustment. You got to go along with what the manager feels is right, whether you like it or not. you know, after we've been around for a while, we think that maybe we have our own ideas of how things should be done, and the manager's in charge, you have to accept that.
Would you like to see him return as manager?
Yeah, if we can go back and be world champions again, I don't care who's here.
I must say, before the game, I came out to Gary Maddox, and I said, Gary, how you feel? He said, I'm nervous. You're not nervous now?
No, I'm happy now. Here, I got a drink for you. Gotta have,
I can't. I'm on national TV, I cannot. The booth. Joe, you've got it.
All right, Brian, right here on the field. What a display. The Philly players came out, led by Pete Rose and Dallas Green, and you see what's happening. A very emotional scene here. You saw it in the clubhouse, now you see it out here, but on the other side, the Kansas City Royals, really not losers. Let's go to Merle Harmon in the Kansas City clubhouse.
All right, Joe, and as you can imagine, it's rather quiet here, but as you said, there can be no loser in a World Series like this, Jim Frey, because you fellas played it right to the hilt. You had a chance to win it in the eighth, you had a chance to win it in the ninth, and no loser in this entire series did not have an opportunity to win in the last inning.
Well, I'm proud of the way the ball club came back in this game. We came back hard in the eighth, and we just couldn't get that base hit in the eighth or ninth. I think that's the whole story of the series. I thought we played as well as they did, but we just couldn't get that one hit or that ball to go in the hole for us. But I want everybody to know that we're as proud as we can be to be Kansas City Royals, because we had one great year.
All right, what about the comeback for next year?
We're going to try. We hope we can be in the World Series and try it again.
All right, Jim, congratulations to you. Now let's go back to Bryant Gumbel.
Okay, Merle Harmon, thank you very much. One of our oldest cities has waited one of the longest times for this moment. They got close to it in 15, got close to it in 50, but a championship has finally come to Philadelphia. Bowie Kuhn, I know you've got some honors to do.
I am delighted to be able to present this trophy representing the World Championship to Willie Carpenter. The skipper here, Dallas Green, the Paul Owen, three men have done a fantastic job to bring this championship to Philadelphia. All baseball is proud of you fellas. Your trophy.
Really, a couple of words on how agonizing the wait for this moment?
Well, Brian, I just hope that this town doesn't have, this franchise has been in existence maybe 96 years, I think I saw in the paper, and I hope to hell they don't have to wait 96 years for another world championship. It's the greatest thing that's ever happened to me in my life. And this man here and Dallas Green, Paul Owens, Dallas Green, and these ball players and coaches and our whole organization have just done a fantastic job for us.
Did you know that Paul and Dallas already consummated a deal for next year? He's back?
No way. We haven't gotten into that yet. No, but it's just the greatest thing that's ever happened to my family.
Really, thank you very much. Dallas Green, Paul Owens, congratulations. Perhaps fitting that it comes down to Philadelphia after a long season that we had many surprises. For a time, it looked like we would not even have any players to play in this World Series. But when you consider that a team comes and occupies first place for only 16 days, manages to win a championship only after being behind in every game, and comes on and wins no game in the series but this last one by more than two runs, maybe the best things in life are worth struggling for. Indeed, in the Philadelphia Phillies case, one has to believe that's true. Joe?
Okay, Brian, thank you very much. You see the celebration here. You heard Jim Frey. And I'll tell you, it was a series that every game, they went to the ninth inning, the 27th out with a chance to win it. A world champion Philadelphia Phillies, 4-1. Tony, you have any thoughts?
Well, I'm going to remember some of the Royals' performances. The Willie Mays Aikens with four home runs, a triple, a game-winning RBI. The frustration of Willie Wilson, a great young player who struck out 12 times, but he will be back because he's very young. That is the Royals' side, and there's some pluses for them, too. Tom Seaver?
Joe, I don't think that I ever saw the Royals play the kind of baseball that they played against the Yankees. We know that they're an awfully fine club, but for me, it came down to the pitching, which, of course, is my heartland. And it comes down to Quisenberry and McGraw. McGraw simply on-pitched the fine reliever from Kansas City, Quisenberry.
Well, the Philadelphia Phillies are the world champions, and all of us at NBC Sports would like to thank some people here in Philadelphia and Kansas City for all the help they gave us. Behind the scenes, Dean Vogelaar, Bruce Carnahan, Brian Burns, Larry Schenck, Chris Wheeler. Our thanks to them. Congratulations to the Phillies. Congratulations to the Kansas City Royals. And for Tom Seaver and Tony Kubek, Joe Garagiola saying so long from